on exercise prescription and load management and shoulder exercise. I request Dr. Ganesan and Mr. Paul to come onto the dais and chair the session, please. Thank you.
All right. Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Ram Krishna. I work as an academic director at AND School, which is South India's first fitness school in Chennai. Today, we are going to go from, till now we were talking about patients, right? Now we are going to get them into clients stage. So right now they are no more patients, they are clients or they are athletes whom we're going to train. So let's look at the various stages of how we go about training. And there'll be a few slides. After the slides, there'll be a few GIFs and we'll have a demonstration of those exercises done here. Hopefully one of you, I'll call some of you, maybe you can do it and we can talk over it. So let's go ahead. All right, basically I'm a sports biomechanist, I'm a performance enhancement specialist and a weightlifting specialist from UK and also a physiotherapist. So here the whole idea is you need to identify various principles in program design, exercise program design. You have to explain, you need to talk with your team and use the model. Because one thing you have to remember, you cannot, you need to have that horses for courses. You would have heard that, right? You cannot have the same workout plan for everybody. I have faced this in the gym where I used to work. You give the same set of workout for everybody and you end up coming with injuries. You have a weight loss package and the trainer would give the same package or somebody for everybody and you ended up with injury. Now how's gonna that work out? Because no two individual has the same capabilities. It differs. So these are a must-know thing for an athlete. Now what are the struggles which as a trainer we face? Now I'm gonna talk. Even though I'm a physio, I'm going to talk here as a trainer's perspective so that I can relate to all the coaches and trainers. May I ask how many of you work out here? Can just raise your hand on a regular, thrice a week at least. Workout need not be lifting weights alone. You can do your calisthenics, stretches, walking, anything. How many of you are swimming, cycle? A good 50%, yeah. I hope the next time we have a session like this, it increases and becomes 80%. Because exercise is a lifestyle. Fitness is a lifestyle. Now, I was discussing with Dr. Manish yesterday night and today morning. What is fitness? Fitness is nothing but it's our ability to withstand stress. And this stress could be physical as well as emotional. The environment, the society which we live in, puts stress on our body. And if we are able to withstand the stress, that could be our work, daily life. That is what fitness is all about. It's not about lifting weights. It's not just about running on a treadmill. It needs to be a walk of life, a way of life. And when we get into that, that's when you work upon performance. And when we say performance, it is not just about sporting performance. Performance regards to your job, your activity. But today it's being shoulder, so we'll focus slightly more on shoulder. But these concepts can be used for most of the requirements. So like again, going back, these are the struggles which we face. The most important of them is time nahi hai. I don't have time. Romba busy a irukum, right? So let's work around that. Yeah, according to ACSM, again, unfortunately, I have to quote ACSM because India, 2.1 billion, we still haven't done any researches in fitness, which is sad to see. Hopefully down the line, when I do my PhD, I will do something on that. But according to ACSM, it's been proven, given fact that you need to do 150 minutes of training per week. Okay, that could be 30 minutes, 5 days a week or 50 minutes, 3 days a week. Basically, some kind of physical activity has to be done. And technical ability, now here comes the most biggest problem. I'm not talking about technical ability of the client. We are there to teach that. It's the technical ability of the trainer or the physio. That's where you need to upgrade oneself. You need to know how and what to go about it. Now, what is performance enhancement? That sounds very fancy, the word performance enhancement. You know, I always introduce myself. I'm a performance enhancement specialist because I can promote myself very well. Saying those words, PES, we call it. But performance enhancement includes managing your load. Okay, it includes nutrition, which plays a huge role. And again, psychology, we spoke about it, our previous speaker spoke about psychology. It plays a huge role. When in psychology, when you face a situation, we call it as, you either look at it as a threat or look at it as an opportunity. An athlete, an elite athlete will look at it as an opportunity and you find a solution in that. When you look at it as a threat, that's when it leads to a problem and issues. and fear comes into play, and fear can lead to injuries. So that's the importance. So in nutrition and psychology plays a huge role, as much as important like how would a weight training or regular fitness would play. So the key is optimal. I would never say perfect. There is nothing called perfection. If we were perfect, we will not be standing here. Okay, we'll be God or whomever you follow. It's all about striving towards the optimal level, best to the best ability. Now when we say normal, again, there are certain words which we used to, I still remember my instructors in physio, they used to say, there's nothing called normal. It's best of to your functional ability. Okay. Now, in a workout plan, when you need to design a workout plan which is best to your functional ability. You enhance that ability. And what is your function? That is why I earlier when I was chairing, I told, as a trainer, as a physio, you need to understand the sport whom you are training, the athlete. You need to understand the movement. The need analysis is very, very important. Now, kinetic chain, I'm not going to go much about it. Everybody has spoken. For people who are not from physio background, how many of you are non-physios here? Or non-medicos? They are pure trainers? Yeah. Simply, exercise language la pesna, kinetic chain is your form, your technique. எப்போ நம்ம நல்லா ஃபார்மில் ஒர்க் அவுட் பண்ணுறோம் வென் யூ ஆல் ஆர் அலைன்ட் ப்ராப்பர்லி யூ ஆர் டாக்கிங் அபவுட் ஸ்ட்ரக்சரல் அலைன்மெண்ட் பிகாஸ் வென் யூ ஹாவ் அ ப்ராப்பர் ஸ்ட்ரக்சரல் அலைன்மெண்ட் இட் லீட்ஸ் டு ஃபங்க்ஷனல் எஃபிஷியன்சி ஸோ பேசிக்லி ஸ்ட்ரக்சரல் எஃபிஷியன்சி லீட்ஸ் டு ஃபங்க்ஷனல் எஃபிஷியன்சி அண்ட் தட் ரெடியூசஸ் த இன்சிடென்ஸ் ஆஃப் இன்ஜுரி தட் இஸ் வாட் இஸ் கைனடிக் செயின் இஸ் ஆல் அபவுட் ஐ மீன் இஃப் இட் ஹவ் பின் அ பயோமெக்கானிக் செஷன் ஐ கேன் டாக் அ கப்பல் ஆஃப் அவர்ஸ் ஓன்லி ஆன் கைனடிக் செயின் பட் அன்ஃபார்ச்சுனேட்லி வி டோன்ட் ஹாவ் தட் மச் டைம் ஸோ வீல் ஸ்கிப் தட் ஐ ஹோப் யூ ஹாவ் அன் ஐடியா. When it comes to training, it's all about your form and technique. That is what you need to focus upon because intensity load will come later on. If your form and technique is not right, it will lead to an injury. See, in training, it's all about load and it's all about angles. You change slight angles, the way you work, you keep your hand forward, you keep your elbow forward in biceps curl, it starts loading on your shoulder. Cheating movements, trick movements. How many people work out by, bodybuilders. Those are, and most of them come, even though they're doing biceps, they come with low back pain and neck pain. Because there are a lot of trick movements, cheating movements. And there are exercises which are given to train. There are something called cheat exercises. We work on negative range, or for physios, I could say it, eccentric workout plan. That is what we use it in training. Now, I was having a discussion about said principle. With you, I guess, Dr. Deepak, right? Yeah. So, SAIT principle, specific adaptation to imposed demand. What is it? Basically, it means the body is always trying to get better at what they are doing. You agree with me? So, how do you get better? You need to practice, 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 practice. So, when somebody says practice makes perfect, it is true. But that practice, the load has to be progressively increasing. When we speak about overload, it's all about injury we think about because it leads to acute injury, impact and all that. But in here, overload is progressive overload. You know, if I have to reach up to Ganesh, I cannot just jump from here. I need to take few steps to reach there. That is what is progressing. And that comes with planning. So I'm going to show you certain fitter principle, how much load, how much intensity you're going to work upon it. Now, adaptation. The key thing in training, other than angles, loading is all about adaptation. நம்ம எப்படி அடாப்ட் பண்ணுறோம் அண்ட் தட் அடாப்டேஷன் ஆர் தீஸ் ஆர் த சேஞ்சஸ் விச் ஹேப்பன்ஸ் மெட்டபாலிக் ஸ்ட்ரெஸ்ஸஸ் வேர் யூ டூ பர்ன் அவுட் அண்ட் யூ ஹவ் ஷார்ட் ரெஸ்ட் பீரியட்ஸ் அண்ட் யூ ஹவ் மஸ்குலர் டேமேஜ் மைக்ரோ ட்ராமாஸ் விச் ஹேப்பன்ஸ் இன் த மஸ்குலர் லெவல் இந்த கான்ட்ராக்டைல் யூனிட் ப்ரோட்டீன் தட் இஸ் வேர் நோ பாடி பில்டர்ஸ் ஆஸ்க் மீ சார் சைஸ் எப்படி இன்க்ரீஸ் பண்ணுறது ப்ரோட்டீன் சாப்பிட்டா இன்க்ரீஸ் ஆகிடுமா ஸோ எவ்ரிபடி பாடி பில்டர் வில் கிவ் யூ ஒன் அவர் லெக்சர் ஆன் ஹவு டு இன்க்ரீஸ் ஹைப்பர்ட்ராஃபி. You ask them what is the contractile unit, how it works, they will not have an idea. This is where we need to work upon them. Because just having protein will over the limit, it only going to lead to issues with health. Excessive protein can be converted into fat. It could also lead to kidney issues. Okay, and it can also lead to osteoporosis. So you need to have a proper plan and you need to understand how it works. And just as I like this slide, so I just added it for you to have a look at it. It gives you a viewpoint how an hypertrophy happens. Okay, you have a nutrition, muscle damage. When I speak about muscle damage, it's a micro trauma which happens. You know, your muscles are like rubber bands. You stretch a rubber band and leave it, it comes back. So it has got elasticity. And you keep on stretching tensile strength, right? You remember your physics. So that is what it is. Muscles have, when you think about your muscle, think about a rubber band, and you need to understand the properties of a rubber band. Each rubber band has its thickness and each of them has its stretching capacity. So you cannot just load somebody just like that and lift load. You need to have a correct planning. And that plan happens with periodization. We have all know about periodization, right? We have heard about it. Now, periodization is basically pre-planned variation of stimulus. You apply stimulus to the body, and that stimulus could be your cardio training, it could be your weight training, it could be the loading, it could be your calisthenics workout, it could be any stimuli which you applied and how your body reacts to it. Now, these stimuli are the pre-planned are based upon three stages. You have annual plan, which is macro cycle. So basically, you decide, okay, this month I'm going to focus. This year, so I've got 3 months for planning this. My season starts. Unfortunately, it takes an example of cricket, right? You're finishing your IPL. Now, immediately, you're going for a World Test Championship. IPL, you're working on explosive training. A Virat Kohli would be working on explosive training before a game, so that his muscle work on that way. And the same Virat Kohli, just before the World Championship, he cannot do the same workout. So he needs to work upon endurance workout, you know, muscle endurance. So based upon your sport, it's going to change. And recovery is very key. That is why we need periodization plan. And then you come down to mesocycle, which is a monthly plan. So in mesocycle, you focus upon your fitness components. In the masana, in the component, mala focus panna pora. Okay, you start with conditioning phase. So we'll look at the other slides, we'll know what are those conditioning phases and how we work upon, and weekly plan. And suppose if I'm going to work on my muscle endurance, which then in this week, how much repetition I work, which muscle I'm going to work, which are my weaker muscle. Those are the things which we'll be working upon. Now, when we talk about workout, right? Workout is like a coin. You have a heads or tails. You cannot have a head without a tail, right? So it's a similar way, you cannot have a workout without fitness and fatigue. Fitness and fatigue are two opposite sides. One, you cannot have one without another. So when you work out, you're going to have the fitness aspect of it, and you're going to have the fatigue part of it. Now it's up to your skill set, and it's also up to the capability of the client or athlete, which one dominates. So our way is to improve the fitness so that the fatigue reduces. You can never be without fatigue. We can never be superhuman being. It's all about recovery. It's all about how you bring it down. That's where sports nutrition comes into play, where intra-workout, pre-workout nutrition, post-workout nutrition, which will help in enhancement, performance enhancement. So those things comes into play, and at the end of the day, what do we need? Performance, right? The goal is to perform properly to the best of their ability. And that is where it all comes down to. Now, these are the concepts in periodization. What happens when your body is adapting to training? The first thing, you get soreness, temporary. And when you get soreness, your temporary drop in performance happens. That is a key thing. Not to worry. We call it as DOMS, delayed onset of muscle soreness. Inik workout panna nalikda vali teridum namak. And what do clients are doing? They don't come to the gym. I said, or anybody, or inik vali kide nalik panlam. Then what happens? That's when the soreness, recovery, again, it comes back into play. So you need to advise the client. You need to create an awareness among your athletes how important warm-up is, how important cool-down is, what stretches would you do in warm-up, what would you do in cool-down. And those things only will reduce these, concepts of, adapting or, I would say, periodization. Then you come into changes in structure, which is you call as resistance. Then exhaustion. Here is where you limit. Okay, there is a potential limitation for each body, where beyond that you have difficulty, because you try to go beyond this exhaustion level, it leads to overtraining. There is something called overreaching and overtraining. Are you aware of what is the difference? Yeah, what is overreaching? Anybody can tell me what is overreaching in exercise? Yes, you go into closer to the supra maximal level. When you start feeling the soreness. Now what happens in athlete or in regular client when they go into high intensity training, we tend to, not bother about that. Once we cross overreaching, we don't try to take care of that supra maximal level soreness and all, it leads to overtraining. And that is when you get to overtraining, it leads to injury. Let me tell you one simple concept. Recovery from overtraining will take 3 times more time than a regular injury. If there's a grade one injury, regular, and anybody, and there is an overtraining grade one injury, the overtraining fellow will take 3 times more longer time to recover from that. And that is where a physio or a trainer, one who has a knowledge about that, needs to train the athlete. So this I've already spoken to you about macrocycle, mesocycle, and microcycle. And microcycle can last up to, we as a trainer, we focus on microcycle because end result, clients always want immediate result. You know, 3 months, I'm going to get married, or my cousin is getting married, or my relative, I need to fit into that dress. I want result. Okay, so it is very difficult. You need to work around that. So I'm just going to show you some, tabular column, which will give you an idea. Now, if you look at here, that preparatory phase is what you call it as off-season. Okay, the off-season is divided into 2 ways. One is general preparatory, where you focus on general fitness. Okay, then you work on specific preparation, where you work on functional training. And then comes your pre-competition, where you work on sport-specific training. Then you go into competitive phase, or you call it in-season. Now, in-season, the whole idea is, yes, you can do weight training in-season, but your idea is to maintain what you have gained. If you try to push too much, this is what happens when over-exuberance, right, over-excitement, we tend to push, and that's when it leads to injury. So in-season, it's all about maintaining what you have gained in the off-season and pre-season. And then comes the most important, this is where a physio would play a very important role, is transition phase. After a season, some of the athletes might have some kind of injury, right? And that injury could be neglected, a discomfort. If you leave a discomfort, it can become a disability over a period of time. So you need to focus on that discomfort, make sure that there is a transition. Like, for example, you look at Premier League football. Season's going to get over next in a couple of weeks. And what do? They go for holidays, trips, and all that. But the physios and trainers would tell the athletes to do certain program. You can eat, you can enjoy, have a drink or so, but make sure you maintain your fitness level to a certain. That is why pre-season is very, very important when they come back for tournament. Off-season and pre-season is very important when it comes to training. Then you come into a mesocycle. This is how the table will look like, where you're dividing into monthly, each time into monthly. In the maso na idan train panna pora, in the maso na conditioning panna, artha maso endurance improve panna, adagapram power le focus panna. This is what we do it in times of mesocycle, all right? Then you look at recovery, planned recovery, you see it 4:1, 3:1, and 2:1. What does that mean? It is the 4 days of training, 1 day of recovery. Recovery is the most key thing, I would suggest. If you don't give proper recovery, whether it's between the sets or between the workout days. I remember when I was training a bodybuilder, I used to give him during the cutting down phase or just before pre-competition, 2 days recovery in a week. Okay, and especially even for athletes, you have 1 day is full recovery, 1 day is partial recovery, or you just go to the pool and relax and, you know, just do some kind of stretches, but you won't be working out. Because unless you don't have proper recovery, you will not have the gains. That is why they say, right, you have to sleep. Nalla thoonguno. At least 7 to 8 hours you need to sleep post-exercise. Because if how much ever workout you do, how much ever diet you take, if you don't have a proper sleep, your results will not come properly. So that is what you need to work upon. And this is your microcycle, how it looks. You see, each of them are per weekly. So weekly plan. So end of the day, this is how your periodization will look like, a table. I'm not saying, this is very much evident if you're working with athletes or you have nationals meet, you have yearly once or yearly twice. So periodization can be done for 6 months or a yearly package, but it is very difficult to manage it for people who play round the year. People who play round the year, you need to really manage their recovery period. That's why you see athletes or international athletes are taking off from their game. Like Virat or Rohit, they don't play certain games which they feel is not important. Agar kal Afghanistan ke saath match hai, so we'll not play. Because it's better to take recovery, because that is very important. And that is where we need to focus as an athlete, we need to guide them. Now, these are the 3 levels, stabilization, strength and power. We need to focus on performance enhancement, and these 3 levels are further divided into 5 phases. stabilization endurance, where you work up on strength endurance, then you work up on hypertrophy as you go into the strength and maximal strength and power, all right? And this is what you do. How? What is your program overview? What do? You first assess. Any client or any athlete comes to you, you need to focus upon the requirement of the athlete. You need to know the goals of the athlete and fine-tune that goals, micromanage that goal, and then know the capability of the client. Okay, and then you design customized plans and execute the plan. These are various. I recently had a discussion in Insta with somebody, what exercise order should I do? What should be done first and what should be done later? There is no particular order per se. My personal opinion, I would say any order which gets you the result and reduces the incidence of injury. And the order of an exercise should be based upon the requirement and the goal of the client. Somebody says that larger muscle group should be done first and then the smaller muscle group. In some cases, that plays right. But in some cases, what happens if you do smaller, if you do larger first, when you do smaller muscle group, fatigue sets in. They are not able to do. So it's all about the individual which you need to focus upon. Don't get confused with the small nitty-gritties. Focus on the client, their requirement and goal, and reduce the incidence of injury. That is what is very important. So these are the variables which we focus upon. Repetition sets, training intensity, tempo, okay, training frequency. Now, physios plays a huge role here. Now, where does performance enhancement start? Performance enhancement starts when the end of the rehab period. While the rehabilitation is ending, that is when your exercise plan is starting. So physio has a huge role to play in the initial stages of workout plan. I told you about stabilization. What is stabilization? What is involved there? Is there something called corrective exercise plan? So what is corrective exercise plan? Can anybody tell me, physios or anybody, what is a corrective exercise plan? What do we focus upon? Anybody? I mean, if I'm the only one who's going to speak, then we're going to sleep very soon on the floor. Oh, you're going too deep into it, yeah. Let's not go so deep into biomechanics. Yes, you are right. Corrective exercise plan is identifying the what are the issues with the posture. We spoke about kinetic chain alignment, right? There are three components, muscular, bones and joint, and neural pathway, which involves balance and imbalance. Let me come back shortly to a kinetic plan. There's something called, most of the injuries in a gym, if you look at it, it happens because of imbalance. Imbalance leads to cumulative injury. Cumulative injury leads to inflammation. Inflammation leads to spasm. Spasm leads to adhesion formation. Adhesion formation leads to altered neuromuscular facilitation. Altered neuromuscular facilitation leads to imbalance. Imbalance leads to accumulation. So it's a vicious cycle. So as a trainer, my job is to focus on the imbalance. I cannot do anything there. Other places where a physio would come into play. So correct on the imbalance. That is what happens in the corrective exercise plan. You lengthen, you activate the muscle. First you lengthen the muscle, then you activate the muscle, and then you work upon the muscle. So that is what happened, and these are the various assessment which we do. Transitional assessment and dynamic assessment, which we do it as in terms of sporting event. You need to understand the sport which is played. And then come to fitness test. Because it's going to be a shoulder, you do a push-up test. You sit and reach, or as basic as sit and reach test. Or you can do a pull-up test, which we have already seen earlier. So these are what you focus upon. So, and also, if you look at it, the static assessment, you look at upper distortion pattern, forward neck posture. We spoke about that earlier. That can lead to issues in your play. So you need to have it. That's why I said physios plays a huge role. This is what we focus upon. When you are going to train somebody, I call this as a pyramid of training, where you start from general fitness, where corrective exercise plan and muscle endurance, then you go into strength endurance, muscle strength, HIIT, which is very popular nowadays, which people misuse and leads to injury. Okay, many of them don't know what is HIIT actually. They know it is high intensity interval training, but they tend to give it to everybody. And that is where injury happens. So you need to have an awareness. And last, it comes to power and hypertrophy. There's one more actually on top of this. We call it as power endurance. For athletes like boxing, where you just don't need one. Power is all about 1 RM. And you need to work repetitive over that. So let's see how it works. this is what it goes into. Okay. Now, when you look at shoulder stability, that's where I say physio involvement is much more higher. Just a repetition. The second stage is where loading happens. You start working on increasing the load, progressive overload, strength development, then muscle enhancement, hypertrophy, hyperplasia. All this thing comes into place in the second stage. And the third one is when it is sport specific. I would like to ask one more question here. What is the difference between power training and explosive training? Because everybody, we tend to, when we overhead, we talk about javelin throw, shot put, these are all explosive training. What is the main difference between power training and explosive? Are they same? What is power? How do you define power? Yeah? Rate of force production, yes. Power, right? So, or you could also say power equal to force into velocity or force into speed, if I need to go into physics of it, right? Thank you. And what is explosive? So what is the difference in training? So power training has to vary from explosive training. And the difference comes in range of motion. When you train power, you need to go to the end range of motion. Whereas when you train explosive, you don't go to end range of motion because you lose that power. So if you look at a rubber band, you stretch. It has got a stretching capacity up to here. You train the whole range of motion when you train power. But when you train explosive, like your plyometrics, you train within this. You stretch and leave it, it comes back quicker. You stretch more and leave it, it takes time to come back. It all depends upon you want to improve the explosiveness, you want to work within those range of motion. You don't need to take to the limit of range of motion. That is what is a major difference between power training and explosive training. Now, I have spoken about it in the morning. Proximal stability promotes distal mobility. Shoulder issues are some of the most common in overhead injuries. Why? Because we are not focusing on our scapula. The shoulder stability, the scapula is the base of all our shoulder movement. If you want to enhance your shoulder exercise, you want to enhance your mobility, you need to focus on the scapula stability. Otherwise, there will be leading to dysfunctions. And this is where a physio need to have a knowledge about how to work upon this. So this is what your take home should be from this slide is proximal stability promotes distal mobility and mobility leads to performance. So focus on stability, focus on mobility, then go into performance. That should be your progression of training. So this is already I spoken about. This is further division of what I spoke. And corrective exercise, integrated stabilization, then you work on to muscle endurance, then you work up onto muscle enhancement phase, then you work up onto power phase. If you look at power phase, there are two stages which are elastic equivalent, which I spoke about. You need to express quicker. So when you say about elastic equivalent, you can't go to the full range. When it is power, like I said, you go into the entire range of motion when you train. That is what we focus upon. Fitter principle. Before I get into the demonstration of exercise, show you a few exercise, let's look at fitter principle, frequency, intensity, time and type. That's what we focus upon. But the tempo of the workout matters a lot on the load you're lifting. Higher the load, okay, faster the tempo. Like you look at clean and jerk and snatch. Okay, if you're working in that, you will not be able to do it slowly. Whereas if you take, if I'm going to move it quicker, I will not feel the load of it in my hand. But if when I'm going to do it slower, I'm going to have the feel of it on my hand. So the tempo matters a lot. So when you're talking about muscle endurance, this is what it works. This is your fitter principle where you work upon 3 to 5 times a week, 40% to 60% of 1 RM. Or low load, 15 to 20 reps, and then you work around calisthenics and machine. Why on machine initially? Because when you go into, because machine provides you assisted resisted workouts, and also machine gives the pulley system in the machine helps you out, and it provides you with artificial stabilization. But the main thing here is don't use machines for longer period if you are into an athlete. Because if you start using machines over a period of time longer, your core stability will reduce. Your natural core activation will reduce. So as soon as possible, you need to get into using free weights as well, if you're an athlete or if you're trying to get into a next level of training. The tempo, 2:4, 2 is concentric movement, 4 is eccentric movement. It is actually very tough. Imagine if a client is saying, this weight is very less. ரொம்ப லைட்டாக இருக்குது, இன்னும் கொஞ்சம் வெயிட் இன்க்ரீஸ் பண்ணலாமா? எஸ் டெஃபினெட்லி இன்க்ரீஸ் த வெயிட். டோன்ட் இன்க்ரீஸ், ஐ வுட் சஜஸ்ட் டோன்ட் கோ ஃபார் ரெப்பிட்டேஷன். ஃபிக்ஸ் யுவர் ரெப்பிட்டேஷன், ட்ரை டு ஒர்க் ஆன் யுவர் லோட் இஃப் யூ வாண்ட் டு என்ஹான்ஸ் தேர் மசில் ஸ்ட்ரென்த் குவிக்கர். அகேன் இட் கம்ஸ் டவுன் டு இண்டிவிஜுவல் எபிலிட்டி. லோட் மேனேஜ்மெண்ட் இஸ் வெரி வெரி இம்பார்ட்டண்ட். திஸ் இஸ் ஃபார் மசில் ஸ்ட்ரென்த். யூ கோ இன் டு, நவ் யூ ஆர் இன்க்ரீஸிங் த இன்டென்சிட்டி. யூ ஆல் ரிமெம்பர் ஃபிசியோ டிலாம்ஸ், ரைட்? டிலாம்ஸ் தியரி ஆஃப் 10 RM. நவ் டிலாம் இஸ் நோன் எஸ் த ஃபாதர் ஆஃப் ஸ்ட்ரென்த் ட்ரைனிங், which he did in 1920s, still we are following that, that good he was. So 10 RM has been proven fact that if you work on your 10 RM and to the best of your ability load, your muscle strength improves considerably. So 10 to 12 repetition is given by the National Strength Conditioning Association in US. They follow, even the Olympic Committee, we follow on 10 RM theory to improve, enhance your strength. 10 to 12 repetition is with. இந்த 10 to 12 ரெப்படேஷனுக்குள்ளே நீங்கள் எவ்வளோ வெயிட் லிஃப்ட் பண்ணலாம் நீங்கள் பண்ணலாம். இட்ஸ் அப் டு யுவர் கெப்பாசிட்டி. யூ ஸ்டார்ட் வித் லோவர் வெயிட் அண்ட் தென் கோ இன்க்ரீஸ் கன்சிடரபிளி. அண்ட் யூ சி ஹியர் ரெப்படேஷன் இஸ் 2 to டெம்போ இஸ் 2:3 ஆர் 2:2 பிகாஸ் யூ இன்க்ரீஸிங் த லோட், டெம்போ இன்க்ரீசஸ். திஸ் இஸ் ஃபார் ஹைப்பர்ட்ராஃபி, 6 to 8 ரெப்ஸ் அண்ட் தென் யுவர் ரிகவரி டைம் இஸ் 1 to 3 மினிட்ஸ் ஹியர். ஏன்னா ஃபர்ஸ்ட் செட் எவ்வளோ நீங்கள் நல்லா பண்ணுறீங்க, செகண்ட் செட்டும் அப்படி தான் பண்ணணும், தேர்ட் செட்டும் அப்படி தான் பண்ணணும். ஓகே, then comes your muscle power. Now you are working on your 100% capacity, 4 to 6 reps you are doing 100% capacity, which the 1 RM which you were doing earlier only 1 repetition, now when you reach the power stage, the same weight you will be doing 4 to 6. So if I check your 1 RM now, it's going to be the same or higher? Higher, right? So now here you work, here your type of the workout will be mostly on barbells. When you work on muscle power, you work mostly on barbells because the loading is different. Now, as a regular goer, people ask, what is the difference between doing the same workout in barbell, dumbbell, and a cable machine? So when you want to improve the thickness of your muscle, it's the barbell which we works upon. The studies are still going on. If you want to improve the peak strength of your muscle, then you work on dumbbell. And you want to work on the definition of your muscle, then you work upon the cable. So as a bodybuilder or somebody who is aesthetically looking good, who wants to get into that, works upon both. But in terms of athlete, you need to cut it down in terms of the requirement. Do the athlete requires that kind of physique? That is what we need to come down. I already told you load management. It is all about how you manage the weight, for whom we saw the repetition, we saw the load, evlo intensity kudukuno. It all comes down to that. Now, managing a load is about the capacity of an individual. Avangala the weight lift panna mudiyuma illaya, that is what we need to look about. I think we have already seen this progressive overload. How do we work upon? Add more repetition, add more sets, increase the frequency, increase more weight, improve your form, and increase under tension. Like you work upon your isometric workout. In fitness, what we do, I think it's the same thing in physio also, we give isometric workout post-rehab. It is very, very important when they come in the, stabilization phase. Because what happens in isometric is your nerve endings get stimulated much more higher, and that enhances the muscle activation. So if somebody is coming post-recovery or return to play, or they need to get into play, isometric is very much useful. And once you've done that, then you go into a isotonic workout or dynamic exercise. But if somebody is not injured, you can directly go into a dynamic workout. It matters a lot. And again, it differ case to case. You need to study the individual very much. Volume. Volume is nothing but how much workout. Evlo workout pandringa or nal. How many sets and reps. So basically, you need to calculate. So this is an example for shoulder exercise. In case shoulder workout, na, I'm going to do seated shoulder press, lateral raise, or posterior raise. All this three reps, and I'm doing hypertrophy. My total volume is what? 72 reps I'm doing. That's what we say, reps volume. So this is what is load management is all about. Now, see three different athletes. When one, the first one, strong, big, and fit. Strong guy is a strongman competitor. You all follow strongman. They don't have aesthetically looking good, but they are the most powerful athlete. So just because you look big doesn't mean you are unfit. Just because you look lean doesn't mean that you are fit. It is about the quality of muscles which you have. And it's your goal. If you look at the center, the big guy, he's a bodybuilder. And the bodybuilder looks very good. You have the physique. But do you think he has the same quality of the muscle as a strongman would have? No. Do you think he will have the same endurance what Cristiano Ronaldo or a football or an athlete would have? No. But that's not his goal. His goal is to have hypertrophy, size. So it's all about your goal, your requirement, and based upon your requirement only, load management can be done. So as a trainer, as a physio, you need to understand the requirement of a client and then design the plan accordingly. And this is where the SAID principle comes. Your key is adaptation to imposed demand. You put the demand and your body will adapt to it accordingly. And upper extremity progression, we are looking at upper extremity. You start with both workouts, like for example, shoulder. I work with bilateral, right? Both workout. Then I'll go with alternate arm. So one,
so
and
you
then
have 5 minutes more.
All right, thank you. And then I go unilateral, one more. So let's look at some of the workouts. Okay, can I have a model quick, somebody here? Yeah? Can you just come in, somebody? Yeah, please come. Can I have a mic? What I'm going to do, he's going to fix a collar mic, sir. It's all right. Thank you. What I'm going to do is show you basic, if you look at the GIF, it's an internal and external rotation, which is the common. Everybody is aware of it. We all do that. But it, in spite of being one of the easiest looking workout, is one of the most effective workouts when you train. As a, in a, all right. Thank you. As a physio expert, or as a strength and conditioning expert, you need to be really aware of what kind of training you need to do, where your positioning of hand has to be. Now, you can hear me at the back, right? So in terms of internal and external rotation, we tend to, this is where the common mistakes, what will happen when you look, as a physio, you can see, but this is what common mistakes happen. You need to keep here, and also make sure your shoulders are not rounded. You keep in the neutral position, your ear should be in line with the shoulder, and slightly forward, and then you work upon your internal and external rotation. Can you do those movements? Yeah, 90. So this is the basic, as much as you can take it. Yeah, but make sure you don't raise it. Okay, this is everybody aware. Now let's come to one of the most important aspect here. Now 90 degrees, we tend to keep it, right? Now when you do keep it 90 degrees and rotate it, you see the, there is an additional torque which is coming into here. So that is going to lead to injury. So my suggestion to you is keep it 70 degrees, and then when you do it, here, if you see, the stress is lesser on the shoulder joint. The common phenomena in anything you have to understand with joints is higher the mobility, lesser the stability. Any joint which has higher mobility will have lesser stability. That is why shoulder joint has more incidence of injuries compared to any other joint, because it moves in multidirectional. Okay. Going into the next slide, lateral raise. If you look at lateral raise, why don't you just raise? So, yes, sure. So if you do a lateral raise, this is the common thing. Now, if you're long lever, short lever. If you're doing a short lever, you will be able to lift much more weight in short lever. But when you do a long lever, the mechanical advantage reduces here. Okay, this is where stress of injuries happen. So in initial stage of training, I would tell you to keep a thumbs up position. In training, whether it's a front raise or side raise. So in a thumbs up position, your focus on training is much more higher, focus on stabilization is much more higher. Remember what I told you, scapular stabilization is the key here. Okay, the same thing goes for front raise. Thumbs up position on an initial stage. Okay, so let's look at, so this is again another progression for you. Where multiple way of raise, four-way raise. This is where your conditioning phase and stabilization phase you will be working upon, where you're working on front raise, side raise, and then you have a bend over. So your back, you're stabilizing your spine, and then you work upon this raise. All right? Sorry about that. Now comes shoulder press. And unilateral. When you do a unilateral, it enhances strength. This is very much important for sporting activities when you work on unilateral. And then military press. Is there a rod here? This is. Thank you. I'll show this here myself. I'll work on it. Thank you. Time. 1 minute?
Time.
Yeah. You know, no, it's fine. I'll finish it in 1 minute. Yeah. So when we talk about shoulder press, okay, your shoulders, your recruitment of muscle is very important. You are on a 90 degrees. Here the difference in shoulder press is you'll not be working on the full range on activation of the muscle. You work around this, and many people tend to do behind the neck. Okay. Now for a bodybuilder, I would suggest that you take it up to the ear level, not beyond, because that could lead to shoulder impingement and injuries. But when it comes to higher intensity of training, just give me 30 seconds. Sorry. So here, let's look at clean and jerk. One of the most important aspects in performance enhancement is when you work towards clean and jerk or snatch, which is a performance training. You work upon this. You all know what is upright row. Here in clean and jerk, what has happened is you clean and explosive. And then from there, you work upon here. So this is what is your clean, right? So you cannot directly go into clean and jerk. So we teach people deadlift, then you go into clean, then hang clean. So clean, hang clean. So these are performance enhancement training where you work upon the loading phase. So there is, so you work upon deadlift where your hip is the driver, you come back, and then you work upon then clean. And when you do clean, you need to make sure your toes. So you do, okay, and then, so this is where you work upon the loading. Now, we saw how we started with external and internal rotation. Then we go into shoulder press. Then we go in a third stage. So starting stage is corrective exercise, where we work upon external and internal rotation. The second stage is loading phase, where we work upon shoulder workout. The third stage is performance stage, explosive, where we work upon clean and jerk. But this is the main criteria for training. I'll just show you an image of my client whom we worked upon before we close it down. These are the various workouts. So, at 4 weeks of training, where we had used this workout plan, supersets workout, you work on your antagonist and agonist together. Okay, so when we worked upon that, these are the example of bodybuilding for mass gain. And while doing that at 4 week, week four, he was in this way. Extremely lean body mass, very difficult to put on mass, so I had to put him under certain nutrition. That is when it comes down to this. So at the end of the day, it's about your goal, how you manage. I would like to close with this open-ended questions to you. I'm sorry I had to little rush in the end. But whom are you going to design the plan? When are you going to design the plan? How are you going to implement it? Why are you doing this? What are you going to do? And where are you going to do? Everything matters. These are the open-ended questions which we need to ask ourselves. Are you up to giving this exercise plan? And it's all about getting strong does not start in the gym. Getting strong starts over here. Okay. So I would consider this session, which is taken a little hurriedly, I know that, a success. Even if 10% of you know now, what are the three phases of training? How do we go from, corrective plan to a performance plan? Okay. Thank you.
Any questions?
All right.
The next speaker will be Mr. Rajkannan.
Told about the guidelines, right?
Yes.
I have a question.
Yeah.
Told about the guidelines, 150 hours per week for exercise.
Yes.
So what sort of, what sort of exercise, whether it is vigorous training?
No. I mentioned it that time. It is for even general public, for even at a general fitness level. It could be even walking. For example, if somebody, at an elderly person who cannot do the gymming workout, he or she wants to go for a walk, even that could be. Or if somebody is going to a gym, that could be also. It depends upon individual capabilities. But the core area is 150 minutes per week.
So if someone does a vigorous training, so that
and that vigorous training need not be all, every other day, consecutive days.
So the hours just change?
It definitely changes depending upon their game, the sport, their capabilities. So suppose you are doing hypertrophy training and explosive training, weekly 2 days is the maximum you give. Because when you work on your power, you work for 2 days a week or 4 days a week. Power training is given to four basic muscles. You're giving on your shoulder, you work on your legs, you work on your chest, and you work on your biceps. These are the power lifting. So you have four muscles, either you work them individual days, or you combine them with some other muscles and work in 2 days time. But make sure you don't work them consecutive days. You need to give at least 48 hours to 72 hours break between them.
Okay.
Right?
Thank you.
Thank you. Yes, sir.
About abduction training, can we spare the 90 degrees and do it in scaption only?
Sorry, I didn't understand your question.
Just 30 degrees slightly turned forwards and training.
Yes, sir. We can definitely do that because that actually helps you to activate the rotator cuff muscle much more better.
Mm.
It does. But again, is it needed for everybody? It again depends upon whom you, that's what open-ended question I gave it. Whom are you going to give it for? What is their requirement? Based upon that, yes. See, even lateral raise, sometimes we do this way, sometimes we do slightly this way, or we do partial. Instead of this two, in the midway range. Because at each, and which angle are you lifting? Either you're going up to this, or sometimes you could give the within this range also.
But I read somewhere that this pure abduction, it's not functionally that relevant. Only scaption comes into operation.
Yeah. Sporting, sorry to interrupt. Yeah, go ahead.
So scaption comes into ADL, everyday activities.
Yes.
So you do only in 30 degrees slightly turned.
Yes.
And so training the arm in that position adds more relevance to the training. Rather than pure abduction like that.
When you, if you're working on a functional training, yes, I would agree to you. But if it's going to be a general activity where we are not aware of how other individual is moving, like pre-lunch, Dr. Manish said, you stand and turn sideways. So if you're doing sudden movement exhaustion, where you're, are you always moving in the house with correct planned way? No. At that time, these unwanted movements happen. So that is why it is no harm in working those ranges. Okay, but if you're working on an athlete, then I would agree with you that it does, it's not functional to work on that range.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, sir.
Sir, இப்போ நீங்க ballistic training, அதாவது இந்த clean and snatch பண்ணீங்கல்ல?
ஆமா.
So, அது இப்போ இருக்க மேஜரா எல்லா athletes பண்றாங்க. விராட் கோலில இருந்து பெரிய athletes எல்லாரும் பண்றாங்க. So, இது பண்றது வந்து ஒரு skill.
ஆமா.
அது ஒரு art தான். ஸோ இந்த ஸ்கில் வந்து எப்படி அவங்களோட மேட்சஸில் அவங்க பிளேயரில் எப்படி ட்ரான்ஸ்ஃபர் ஆகுது?
சி, திஸ் இஸ் ஒலிம்பிக் லிஃப்ட் இஸ் ஒன், இட் இஸ் அ ஸ்கில். இட் ஆல்சோ ஒர்க் ஆன் த டிஃப்ரெண்ட் மஸ்குலேச்சர் விச் தோஸ் மசில்ஸ் ஆர் யூஸ்ட் இன் த மேட்ச் ஃபார் ஈவெண்ட். லைக் ஃபார் எக்ஸாம்பிள், யூ ஹாவ் அ எக்ஸ்ப்ளோசிவ் ஷாட் ஆர் யூ ஹவ் அ சடன் டைவ் வேர் தோஸ் மசில்ஸ் ஆர் கோன் பி யூஸ்ட். ஐ எம் நாட் டாக்கிங் தட் த சேம் ஸ்கில் இஸ் யூஸ்ட் இன் த மேட்ச், பட் யூசிங் தட் ஸ்கில் இஸ் கோன் ஹெல்ப் தெம் டு டூ சர்டன் ஒர்க் அவுட். It's not direct transfer of the skill into the match. It is transfer of the muscle. So, ninga in the clean and jerk pandra time liyo, snatch pandra time liyo, ninga enna muscle workout pandringa, and the muscle and the match liyo use agum. Ana it is used in a different movement. So, inge improve panna, ange effective ah irukum. But I'm not saying this is the only exercise. This is an example.
பிளையோமெட்ரிக்கு பேலன்ஸ் ட்ரைனிங் எல்லாமே அந்த மாதிரி தான் பண்ணிகிட்டு இருக்காங்கல்ல.
எஸ்.
இதில் எனக்கு என்ன டவுட்னா, இப்போ ஸ்கில் வந்து ட்ரான்ஸ்ஃபர் ஆகாதுன்னு சொல்கிறீங்க. இப்போது அதாவது ஒரு டைப் ஆஃப் பேலன்ஸ் ட்ரைனிங் வந்து இன்னொரு டைப் ஆஃப் பேலன்ஸ் ட்ரைனிங்க்கு ஒத்து வராது. ஸோ அதே மாதிரி தான் இப்போது அவங்க எந்த ஸ்போர்ட் பண்ணுறாங்களோ அந்த ஸ்போர்ட்டை தான் விளையாடணும்.
ஐ வுட் நாட் டோட்லி அக்ரி வித் யூ, பிகாஸ் நீங்கள் ப்ரீ சீசனில் பண்ணிங்கன்னா அந்த ஸ்போர்ட்டிங் மட்டும் நீங்கள் ஃபோக்கஸ் பண்ணிங்கன்னா யூ வில் நாட் பி ஏபிள் டு டூ லோடிங். இப்போ ஸ்போர்ட்டிங்கில் இருக்க மூமெண்ட்ஸில் நீங்கள் லோட் போட்டிங்கன்னா இன்ஜுரி ஆகிடும். ஸோ யூ கேனாட் ஜஸ்ட், இஃப் ஐ எம் கோயிங் டு பிளே அ கிரிக்கெட் ஷாட், ஓகே ஐ எம் ஹேவிங் அ ஸ்லாக் ஸ்வீப் இன் த மிட் விக்கெட், ஓகே ஐ எம் டூயிங் தட். த ஒன்லி திங் விச் ஐ கேன் ரிலேட் டு இஸ் அ வுட் சாப் எக்ஸசைஸ், ரைட்? ஸோ ஐ எம் டேக்கிங் அ வுட் சாப் இன் அ கேபிள் அண்ட் டூயிங் திஸ் ஒர்க் அவுட், ஸோ விச் இஸ் யூஸ்ட். பட் ஹவு மச் லோடிங் கேன் ஐ டூ இன் வுட் சாப், இசன்ட் இட்? So what I need to do is work around, but wood chop alone is not just this muscle. It starts with your trunk, your glutes, it comes transfer up to here. So if you work during those workout, like push press workout, neenga pandra time la then explode pandringa, all those will help you to improve that. So neenga direct transfer agalena no, you will work upon the muscle which will help you for the sport.
So can I just put it simplified? So usually vandu pathina transition vandu, it doesn't have to be the same movement also.
That's clean and jerk movement. Virat Kohli idu neenga kekkureenga appadina clean and jerk la vande enak vande and explosiveness varumbodhu and position pombodhu you need to have stability also. Hip oda stability, trunk oda stability, transition to the shoulder and wrist. Then again when you go to short lever to long lever. And the power vande and the muscle memory vande correct time. So here I'm not looking at mimicking the same movement but and the muscle fire aayi stable aayi thirupi adhe generate panna mudiyada. அதை வந்து வி ஆர் மிமிக்கிங் ஸோ நவு கிளீன் அண்ட் ஜர்க் ஆர் ஆல் தீஸ் திங்ஸ் பிளேயர்ஸ் ஆர் டூயிங் 20 இயர்ஸ் பிஃபோர் பிளேயர்ஸ் பண்ணலை அவங்களோட சிம்பிள் மெமரியில் தான் யூஸ் பண்ணுது ஸோ நவு இட்ஸ் ஜஸ்ட் யூஸிங் த காம்பனண்ட் ஆஃப் அந்த ஸ்டெபிலிட்டி அப்ரோப்ரியேட் டைம் ஆஃப் ஃபயரிங் ஸ்டேபிள் அகெயின் ஃபயரிங் அகெயின் ஸ்டேபிள் அதுதான்
நவு வாட் ஹேப்பன்ஸ் இஸ் நவ் த கேம் ஹஸ் பிகம் வெரி ஃபாஸ்ட் அண்ட் இட்ஸ் பிகம் வெரி காம்படிட்டிவ் ஸோ athletes and coaches are finding new ways to improve upon. So what he said, which was not used 20 years back, they are using it now because those components have become much more prevalent now. For a goalkeeper, I would not train him in clean and jerk. Okay, a wicketkeeper, I would work more on close range reaction time. And for that, speed is very much important.
Sir, why don't we shift to PNF? PNF is also spiral movements, functional
yes,
movements.
Yes, that's what
why
I'm saying.
Why don't we directly do that? He's asking the same.
Strength
skill
training
transfer. Skill transfer in PNF, it is easy.
So
spiral movement. And we can train in any sport.
Yes, definitely we can do it. But there is a limit.
Why is it not practiced then?
Sir, no doubt. Power-ங்கும்போது skill plus strength. நம்ம ஸ்ட்ரென்த் வந்து அங்கே ஸ்கில்லோட மிக்ஸ் ஆகும்போது அது பவராக யூஸ் ஆகும்
கேன் ஐ ஜஸ்ட் கரெக்ட் யூ தட் பவர் வந்தது இட்ஸ் நாட் ஆல்வேஸ் ஸ்கில்
ஓகே
இட் இஸ் நாட் ஆல்வேஸ் ஸ்கில் இட் இஸ் மோர் மூமெண்ட் பேஸ்ட் ஸ்கில் என்னது பவர் நீங்கள் பண்ணிங்கன்னா பவர் எக்ஸசைஸ் வில் நாட் ஆல்வேஸ் என்ஹான்ஸ் ஸ்கில் பவர் லிஃப்டிங் பண்ணுறாங்க ஸ்குவாட்ஸ் டெட் லிஃப்ட் பண்ணுறாங்க ஒரு 1 RM ஒர்க் அவுட் அதான் பவர் லிஃப்டிங் 1 RM இஸ் பவர் அதுலேருந்தே உங்களுக்கு ஸ்போர்ட்ஸில் எப்படி யூஸ் ஆகும் So it is about power endurance where well, like what Ganeshan has said you are going to activate those muscle and those muscle in turn will work on your sporting action that is what it is so power not always means skill
the fastest ball so that was in the year 2000 So if your training principles are working, why in the past 10 years, why in this past 10 years, no bowler could break the 10-year-old record of fastest ball in
because,
the year?
Because bowling fast does not just lead to, it's because of, that's what is the same concept. But by doing weight training, you're not going to improve faster. If you look at somebody like Bumrah or Hardik Pandya, who looks very thin and lean, but Hardik Pandya bowls at 145 km/h speed.
No, okay. I was asking a question, why they are not able to break?
Because
with
they
all the advancement in
it all comes down to their muscle ability, the type of muscle fibers they have, so and fast twitch fibers, how they work around it, and how they train. Bowling is a natural ability also. Just by doing a weightlifting, you'll not become a bowler. Like Abhin,
do you have any strategy for that?
Yes, it's run-up, action. Abhin, that is a different forum. I mean, it'll take a long time if I'm going to talk about fast bowling action. There are certain breakdown of components from your run up to at a front foot delivery and all that so the action is varies yeah
sir so thank you Mr. Ram
thank you
thank you Mr. Ram now I would like to call upon the next speaker, Mr. Rajkannan. He's a physiotherapist, a very good friend of mine, and he's currently the director for the Aptar Institute at Bangalore, and he's also the head of the department at RMB Hospital, Bangalore. He specializes in dry needling and pain management. So, thank you, sir.
Okay. Good evening, one and all. It's a pleasure and a privilege to be here. Thanks Ganeshan and the Artho One to provide me this forum. Since morning you have been talking about performance enhancement, injury prevention, mental health in sports and athleticism and so on. I will give you a break. Let's go to the clinicals, okay? The topic is the neuropathophysiology of the shoulder pain. See, as a musculoskeletal physio, 99% of my patients, they come to me with pain. Whether a sports guy or a normal individual, they come to me with pain. Without pain, no human being will go to think of going to a doctor, isn't it? Okay, especially for the musculoskeletal problem. So the pain in animalistic model, when there's a problem in the tissue, the animal responds by withdrawing. That's the inherent nature of our body. But the moment you become human being, you got the brain, you started thinking, the cognition play a role there, then the pain became more of an emotional. That's why the International Association of Study of Pain in the year 2020, they redefined the pain definition. It's not tissue-related pain. You know, there's also a psychological component to that. So it can be actual damage or a potential damage. You can actually have pain without even a damage. So that makes us to think, okay, what we should do better in terms of pain management. Whatever advancement we have in the medical field, still the number one reason for people's disability in terms of musculoskeletal is pain. Okay? And pain is as enigmatic as it was before. And it's because of the complex biology that we have, as well as the complex psychology, that you know how complex it is. Okay, so the shoulder pain is. So the shoulder pain is the third most leading cause of. Thank you. Shoulder pain is the. See, when I get patients in my clinic, you know, by order, I see back pain patients first, and then the neck pain. The third most common reason why people come to me is the shoulder pain, the third leading cause of pain. And we have, okay. So much of money lost, so much of disability, and more surgeries. See, 20 years back when I was treating, this many number of surgeries was not happening. Suddenly, so many surgeries are happening in the shoulder. I don't know, maybe because the injury prevalence are increasing, or incidence are increasing, or more surgeons are doing surgery, or the diagnosis is getting better, or is it over medicalization of the simple phenomena, or even people are greedy. I mean, they wanted to get the improvement so fast. Is this the reasons for the increase of the shoulder surgeries? But in spite of all the surgeries, no, the people are still suffering, isn't it? The diagnosis of the pain is sometimes very, very challenging. And we don't know simply, you know, why it hurts the way it hurts. No, you'll be completely taken aback. Why this fellow is having this much pain? I tried everything. It's not working. So let's go back to the evolution. We have been in this earth for the past, let's say, 20 lakhs years. Okay, before that, you know, by evolution theory, if it is right, then we were all coming from the chimpanzees. But chimpanzees were using their shoulder for mostly hanging related activities, and you see the structure decides the function, isn't it? So since it is hanging like that, or since the scapula is like this, since the scapula is like, you see the scapula here, the angle of the spine and the glenoid fossa is superiorly oriented. So that means there is no subacromial impingement, there is no compression, because if the acromia is like this, then the compression happens. When the acromia is like this and the glenoid fossa is focusing like that, then there is no compression. Even if you do overhead movement, there is no compression. But we human beings, we started walking on 2 feet, isn't it? Ever since we got the bipedalism, then we started using our hands for other reasons. We are not using our hands for walking, but we are using for throwing and hunting animals, carrying weights, and then off late we started to play sports, and then we have been throwing we have been throwing objects in the form of sports like this. You know, the, you know, baseball pitching, the average, the speed at which the ball is thrown is 9000 degrees per second. That's astronomical speed, whereas a chimpanzee can barely throw an object more than 4 to 5 meters. Okay, that's the adaptation that we got, but That's the reason why we are civilized. Now, because of we freed up the hands, we got civilized. We are here now talking and attending the conference. Okay, it's because we have freed up the hands, but it comes with a cost. Okay, in biology, whenever there is something to achieve, there is something to lose, isn't it? So the cost is shoulder injuries, shoulder pains, and so on. You see, the monkeys doesn't get the frozen shoulder. You know why? Because they're always hanging. But our people, 30-year-old, 40-year-old, coming with shoulder. Man, I mean, I ask him, you know, why you are having this? You know, what are you doing every day? Now, morning onwards, I'm working till night, you know, 12 hours, 13 hours. How you work? You work like this. Okay, and then I go to room and then eat food and then I sleep like that. So when was the last time you did this? Of course, they go to gym some here and there. They do it, but not like a monkey. So to even now, evolutionarily speaking, some amount of that traits still there. The genetic difference between the monkey and the human beings is only 3%. Remaining is all same. So if you want to don't have to have a Trojan shoulder, you know, have a hanging bar in your hand in your home, at least every now and then just hang. Okay. And that's what I teach for all my frozen shoulder patients. Now coming back to the shoulder pain, does patho-anatomical model works? Now, it was easy earlier. There's a problem in the anatomy. You fix anatomy, the pain will go away. But it's not the case anymore because there is no correlation or there is not always there's a correlation exists between the structural problem and the pain. We see a lot of patients who have a partial thickness tear in their supraspinatus, then still they'll be having no pain. They will come to you for frozen shoulder. Okay, some people will have a calcific tendinitis, calcific tendon in the supraspinatus, but they will have no pain. So there is no real correlation between the structure and the function, and that's why you have to know why they are not having the pain. So you cannot just brush it off. You need to know why they are not having the pain. That's why you need to know the neurophysiology of the pain that fills the gap between what we know and what we don't know. So the patho-anatomical model, yes, definitely, if you are a physio, you should definitely know the anatomy. At the same time, you should know the physiology as well. Because if anatomy is the king, physiology is the queen. You know, pain is not anatomy. Pain is physiology. Okay. Fracture is a break in the bone. But whether you should have pain or not, that depends upon the neural pathways and the sensitization of the receptors, inflammatory tendencies, all these things will decide the pain. So pain is always physiology. That's why I'm here to talk about the neuropathophysiology of the pain. So at the same time, we cannot ignore the psychosocial aspect because, you know, without the brain, you can't really have the pain. And there are so many attitudes and beliefs that will decide the pain. So as a physio or as a physician or whomsoever you may be in the healthcare field, you should consider the patho-anatomical model structures, and you should know the neurophysiological structures, neurophysiological mechanisms, and the psychosocial factors. All will decide the pain. Now, why you need to understand the neuropathophysiology? To discern between the diagnosis and pain generator. No, I always want to diagnose because I don't want to just simply straight away give the treatment for the symptom, because pain is a symptom. Pain is not a diagnosis. Okay, low back pain is the symptom. It's not a diagnosis. Neck pain is a symptom, not a diagnosis. Similarly, shoulder pain is a symptom. It's not a diagnosis. Why it is paining? I just want to answer that question. At the same time, I want to know what is the pain generator, the structure which is producing the pain. For example, in frozen shoulder, the capsule, the inflamed capsule, the contracture capsule is the pain generator, and the diagnosis is frozen shoulder. So for every condition, there must be a pain generator, and then there will be a diagnosis. And you need to know and acknowledge why it hurts. Why this patient with frozen shoulder is hurting less, this patient with frozen shoulder does hurting more. Why this patient with a supraspinatus tendinitis has barely any pain, whereas this guy is crying with pain, unable to sleep for the past 3 days. So you need to know the differences. You need to answer that why component. Okay, and then you need to make sense of severity and irritability of the pain and choose. Then once you know the pain, you will be able to treat correctly. You will be able to choose the right form of treatment. At the same time, I can assure my patients, okay, you'll be fine in 1 month, you'll be fine in 3 months. At least I'll be able to predict certain timeline when they will improve. And at the same time, with this knowledge, you'll be able to educate and empower the patients. Now, let me briefly go through the neuropathophysiological pathway. Now, how the pain starts? Now, something must happen in the tissue level, isn't it? Without something must happen in the tissue level, no, there is no stimulus for the receptors. We're all full of receptors. The free nerve endings, the nociceptors, mechanoreceptors, chemoreceptors, they are the first line of information carriers from the tissue, and then that will be carried via the nerves, and that carrying process is called as transmission. The first one is transduction. The stimulus is converted into electrical impulses by the receptors, that is transduction, and then the message will be carried by the nerves to the spinal cord, that is called as transmission, and then in the spinal cord it gets modulated. You know, some trick happens in the spinal cord by the interventional neurons, and then some discerning pain control mechanisms will happen in the spinal cord. So that can modulate the pain here and there. So if you're unlucky, you will have more pain. If you're lucky, you will have less pain for the same tissue trauma because something happens in the spinal cord. At the last, the perception. It's a brain that perceives the pain. You know, if you have your somatosensory area infarcted, you will not feel the pain because there's nothing to perceive it. So even though the stimulus goes as electrical impulses, it doesn't go as a pain. It goes as electrical impulses to the brain. It's a brain that gives the meaning to the pain. So these are the four processes that is involved in the pain's perception. But it is not so easy that every time there's a tissue trauma and then the patient is having a pain, there can be a problem in the nerve pathway. The problem can be in the nerve pathway, or the problem can be in the spinal cord that can cause the pain. If you see the body, when the child is formed in the womb, the child, it will layer into three layers: the outer ectoderm, the middle mesoderm, and the inner endoderm. The outer ectoderm, from there only all the organs will differentiate. The outer ectoderm will divide into brain, spinal cord, and the nerves and the skin. That means the skin and the nerves are so close to each other, they derive from the common layer. The inner endoderm, they differentiate into organs, GIT, liver, kidney, and so on. That's why the brain has poor capacity to understand what's happening inside the organs, whereas the brain has the rich capacity of what's happening in the skin. That's why if there's a problem in the skin, you will be able to understand easily. The middle one, the mesoderm, is the one which differentiates into the muscles and the fascia and the joints. They don't have one-to-one connection like the skin. They have a little bit of diffuse. That's the reason why if there's a problem in the infraspinatus or if there's a problem in the tendon of the supraspinatus, the patient will not know, okay, my supraspinatus is hurting. He will not say that. He will say the pain is there. Okay, whereas if the problem is in the, let's say, olecranon bursa, patient with the olecranon bursitis, he will say my pain is here. When the problem is the tennis elbow, they will say the pain is here. So when the problem is superficial, it is ectoderm problem. So the locality is better. The problem is in the inner endoderm or the mesoderm, the locality is very bad. So the patient cannot able to identify, or even the doctor cannot identify what is the structure which is causing the pain. So that's why some of my patients, no, they say, doctor, my pain is here, now treat it here. No, the patient, or they say, my muscles are tight, or my muscles are weak, or my muscles are taut. It's always spasm. So these are the things that my patients say, but I say them that the patient's own perception of their problem or their self-diagnosis may not be the true representation of what's actually happening inside their body. So now, the diagnostic acumen, the pain does not always determine the diagnosis. Don't go by the pain and think why there is a pain. Go back to the diagnosis. Location of the symptom does not directly imply the pain generator. In frozen shoulder, pain will be here. Where is the problem? In the capsule. Do you understand? Okay. In radiculopathy, pain will be here. Where is the problem? In the neck. So it will be actually deceiving the, and labral tear, pain will be deep inside. Sometimes in bony Banket's lesion, pain will be, the bone Banket's lesion can actually refer sometimes pain to the deltoid. Okay, and then that causes a severe pain in the deltoid. You treat, it's a muscular problem, you treat the deltoid. So once you do the MRI, you will come to know, because it happened once like that. You know, I did the MRI, then it was a bony Banket's lesion, then we had to operate her. Okay, so the locality of the symptom does not always correlate with the diagnosis. So you think, and I'll tell how to do these things. Okay, and imaging can be always misleading, because more and more MRIs are happening, so obviously more and more diagnoses are happening. So you need to understand what to be ignored and what to be considered in the MRI findings. And referred pain cannot be realized. You know, when you have a kidney stone, you don't know that you have a kidney stone, you have back pain. It is as deceiving as that. Gallbladder stone, you will not know that. You don't know that it's a gallstone, it's an abdominal pain. Okay, once you do the ultrasound scan, you'll know it. Because the brain cannot exactly appreciate the conscious presence of the gallbladder or the kidney. Okay, same way, some areas in the body, like some deep tissues or the fascias or the muscle sometimes, they don't really represent into the brain. So it uses other nerves to express its pain. Even it can cause referred tenderness. Now, what is the missing link in terms of the diagnosis? All I ask is, do a pain generator. Do understand what is a pain generator. And then do understand what is the nature of the pain you're having. And then you do a clinical clustering and then make a diagnosis, okay? Now, what is a pain generator? Pain generator is a structure that is primarily the sole reason for the nociceptive stimulus that is causing the pain. It is that structure which is causing the pain, okay? And then, let me play some game. In frozen shoulder, what is the pain generator? The inflamed capsule is the one which is pain generator. Though the patient say the pain is here and here, you know that they go to Ayurvedic shop and then get some Ayurvedic oil and then apply. It's a referred pain. Okay, it's not actually the problem here, but they feel nice. Because whenever there's a referred pain, you feel always nice to get the massage or compress there. And that's how your TENS and IFT machine works. Okay, in rotator cuff tendinitis means inflammation, the injured tendon is inflamed now, that is causing the pain. So that is the pain generator for the tendinitis. In fracture, the broken periosteum is the pain generator. In dislocation, injured labrum is the injured labrum, when the shoulder joint is dislocated, it will pierce the capsules and the ligaments, and then it will rupture it. That ruptured will cause the inflammation, and that causes the pain. Arthritis, inflammatory mediator, is a chemical pain. So it's an inflammatory pain that causes the pain, and later on it can lead to periosteal attrition. Radiculitis, what is radiculitis? Pain coming from the spinal nerve. It's a big field here. Now, because when there's a shoulder pain, you need to consider the neck as well. So as a doctor, you need to understand what damn structure is causing the pain. Okay, because I want to see the biology first, then the psychology. Okay, can you imagine a pain in your nose now? Can you create a pain in your nose now? Can you? You can't. Okay, you don't even remember where is your nose until you, I told you. So you cannot create a new pathology or a pain by just imagining the pain, but when there's an already a pain, you can amplify the pain with your brain. So for me, it's the biology first, okay, and then the psychology last, okay. So nature of the pain, what is the nature of the, now, once you know the pain generator, what is its nature? Okay, mechanical. What is mechanical? Movement induces pain. See, for example, when you are lifting your baby like that for a long time, you get the pain. That's mechanical pain. Or when the labrum is torn, anterior labrum, anterior superior labrum is torn, you do that movement and do this workout, deep shoulder pain, man, your labrum is crying. Not to do it. Okay, not to strengthen the muscle. Preserve the labrum for timing, let it heal. Okay, so the movement is inducing the pain, that is mechanical pain. Okay, inflammatory pain. Now, when there is an injury, it causes inflammation. So that inflammation, like rheumatoid arthritis is an inflammatory problem causing secondary degeneration compared to osteoarthritis, which is the primary degenerative problem. So in RA, inflammation is the primary reason why people get the pain. So as an acute tendinitis, like acute Achilles tendinitis, acute tennis elbows, there, you know, you don't strengthen because it has to heal, right? Okay. The third one is the radicular pain. This is the most important thing because of late I am seeing more and more number of radicular pains because of the mobile postures and computer postures. Now, that causes pain anywhere. It can cause radiating pain. You know, when the nerve is compressed in the neck and that nerve, the brain will not know that it's compressed in the neck. The brain will know only the pain here. And these people will be doing this till here and then they do this and then they keep doing this. But the problem is in the neck, okay? And that can very well cause the shoulder pain. So, and finally, the referred pain. My God, referred pain is the nemesis and the curse for the doctors and the physios because you will not know where the pain is coming from. Okay, and if you're like a heart attack referring pain to the shoulder, okay, there are instances when people put heart pack in the shoulder because they think it's a muscular pain and rather it was a heart attack. And then he had to be hospitalized. So that's why referred pain is actually very, very deceiving. What structures can refer pain? Whatever structure which is derived from the mesoderm, the middle layer, like myofascial structures, the labrum, the deep tendons, they are the one which refers pain to the, and even organs, the dura maters, they can refer the pain. Ischemic pain in the shoulder is very rare. Since everybody is talking about strength training, you know what, there's a syndrome called Paget-Strozzi syndrome, where they do a lot of chest press and then that can cause a compression of the axillary vein that causes secondary thrombosis in the vein that can lead to DVT. So in that case, they get an acute pain that is called as ischemic pain due to lack of blood supply. Okay, and then central referred pain, I don't want to talk about it, but it's mostly like conditions like thalamic syndromes or so, infarction, they get a central referred pain. So these are the types of pain. So if you're dealing with the pain, if you're calling yourself as a pain therapist, get to know these structures. I mean, these are the natures of the pain. Okay, but it's not so easy. It's all mixed. Okay, in a frozen shoulder, the capsule is inflamed. It is tight. The patient has a movement. The capsule stretches. The patient gets the pain. Okay, so an inflamed capsule is getting stretched mechanically, causing mechanical pain. That too, the pain is referring into the mid-arm deltoid. So it's both inflammatory, mechanical, and referral. So it's that complicated it is. Okay. In the acute traumatic tear, let's say someone has done something and immediately the tendon is torn, it causes inflammatory pain. Once it is inflammatory, you can't lift. So inflammation is restricting your movement. So this is primary inflammatory, secondary mechanical. Okay, now see this picture. Sometimes the pain locality helps you. The pain locality helps you in making a diagnosis. The first picture if you see here, AC joint. Always AC joint problem, they show the pain here. Okay, always. If they don't show the pain here, this is not AC joint problem. Okay, because it's superficial, ectoderm. Easily represented to the brain, one-to-one connection, so always the patient say the pain is here. Whereas if you go to the frozen shoulder, it's fully here. Because frozen shoulder, they won't say my capsule is tight here, it's painful, no, nobody will say. It's diffuse and referred pain. And then the labrum is between the greater tuberosity and the coracoid process, the patient deep pain, deep to the shoulder, that's labrum, and then delta trachea points, and then quadrilateral space syndrome. So based on the pain locality, and you see the number sixth picture, where the pain is coming from, it's a discogenic source. So when the pain is medial scapular region, that's a hint for you, just treat the neck first. Because medial scapular area is governed by C3, C4, okay, which is not governed by C5, C6. So if the pain is medial scapular, just treat the neck because that's an indication that the pain is coming from the discogenic source from the cervical spine. The seventh picture, you know, easy, is coming from the nerve. The eighth picture can be anything. So caution, at times the pain locality will be misleading, especially with an underlying radicular or the referred pain. Now, the third thing is, now you understood the pain generator. Secondly, you understood the pain mechanism. Third thing, you need to do a clustering. What is clinical clustering? Two or more symptoms put together, you get the diagnosis rather than only one symptom. Okay. So that will help you to ascertain the diagnosis. So when there is a joint crepitus, what's the diagnosis? You don't know. When there's a joint crepitus with aging, like 8 years old, do you make a diagnosis? Maybe. But when there's a joint crepitus with aging, which is 80 years, and then you have end range pain, that easily tells you that it's arthritis of the shoulder joint. So you have to do a clinical clustering to get to know what's the diagnosis. Now this lady, middle age, female, woke up in the middle of the night with the pain. Range of motion, active range of motion is restricted, even passive is restricted, but good internal rotation range. When the IR is better, you can fairly rule out frozen shoulder. When the IR is better, you can rule out fairly the frozen shoulder. And this lady, could you see the flexion is limited to almost like 120 degree. It's only 120 degree possible. Abduction is only nearly like 90 degree. But if you see her internal rotation, the internal rotation is somewhat better, you see, that's classic internal rotation. Now, this is not frozen shoulder, there could be something else which causes this pain. So, the clinical clustering for calcific tendinitis is this. You know, AROM and PROM can be restricted, sometimes unequally or equally, but IR will be good. And then these are the things which happens for the middle-aged ladies. Wake up in the middle of the night with acute pain is a sign of calcific tendinitis. Okay, so that time you should not just, during acute stage, they need probably an NSAID, or in chronic cases, they need some form of unremitting or recalcitrant cases, they need some surgery, okay? But most of the people will do well with conservative management. You see this lady, her abduction is absolutely fine.
While doing any pain, as
we do this? Abduction is absolutely fine. So any orthopedician or physician, just by seeing that, they'll say it is not a frozen shoulder. But this lady's internal rotation is in I'm checking in prone lying. I'm not checking in this standing. I'm checking in prone lying. Because if you want to truly test the internal rotation, check in prone lying, because that's where it initially begins to get restricted. So if you see that shoulder, right shoulder, the internal rotation is restricted, which is an indication of this lady is freezing. Freezing. What is freezing? Freezing stage of frozen shoulder, which no one will pick up. Okay. Most of the people will come to us after 2 months or after 3 months. A doctor, I got stuck. What did you do all these days? I thought it's a catch, it'll go away. It didn't go away, it got stuck. Okay, now once it is frozen, then it's difficult to treat after that. So what I say is, check the internal rotation in the prone lying, and if they are having a history of diabetes or pre-diabetes, old women, middle age, that's a classic.
While doing any pain, as you do this?
That's a thing. So identification of the early freezing stage of frozen shoulder is important. You see this lady, okay? By look only, you can easily tell that she's having what condition? Okay, easy, drop arm test positive. Okay, straight away, it's a contractile problem, agree? It's a contractile, because only in the contractile problem, the eccentric drop will be there. Okay, it's a contractile problem. In labrum also, you won't get the eccentric drop. In contractile problem, we'll have an eccentric drop, which is a drop arm test positive. And then this lady have got improved in 7 days time, just 7 days time, she got improved. And just because she's improved, you can fairly say that what it was, the reason for the pain is tendinitis, not tear. Okay, at least clinically she improved, so it's a tendinitis. So in this way, you have to do clinical clustering to get to know the diagnosis. So most of the diagnosis you can do without even an MRI, if you follow these principles. Okay, that's a classic sign of suprasonic tendinitis, where eccentric drop problem, and then due to trauma induced, acute, night pain, pain during movement, and these are the things that, and PROM will be full. PROM will be full because it's not a contractile problem. It's a contractile problem. When you do passively, it will get improved. The range will get improved. So that's the way you differentiate between contractile and the articular problem. Articular means joint problem. Okay, when the joint is stiff, you can't even do the PROM, isn't it? So do understand, whatever the problem in the shoulder, it's all taken by the C5 nerve. C5, C6 is the governing godfathers of the shoulder joint. The major nerve that takes the nerve supply is the suprascapular nerve. You see, all the problem, labrum, labral tear, tendinitis, bursitis, subacromial pain syndrome, tricky points, slap lesion, tendinitis, they all have to be carried by only one nerve, C5, C6, that's all. The body's brain will get confused, where it is coming from, hey, where are you coming from? Are you from the labrum, are you from the bursa, where are you coming from? So the brain will get confused, and this causes referred pain.
And this pain pattern governs, this patient thinks that they got gastric catch and then they take gastric tablet. Because some people get shoulder pain, they get pandy. Okay, man, no, don't do that. Okay. So it does not have a dermatomal pattern, myotomal pattern. It's a unique pattern. Only with experience you'll know it. Okay. So when the problem is in the labrum, it can refer to the muscle. Vice versa. Okay. It can be feeling deep in the joint, but it can be coming from the muscle as well. So you need to do a classic diagnosis. You need to spend at least, I don't do quick diagnosis and quick treatment. No one can be diagnosed in 2 minutes and then treated in 3 minutes. No, you have to spend at least 20 minutes to do the diagnosis. And C5 is the biggest culprit here in the shoulder pain. Morning it was somebody saying shoulder pain and from the neck pain. It is true. It is actually more than what it is. You wait for another 10 years, 50% of the shoulder pain will be coming from the neck. You know why? In another 10 years, 50% of the shoulder pain will be coming from the neck, because we are having more neck pains now. Who is not having neck pain here, you tell me? Anybody here who doesn't have a neck pain? Everyone touch here, you'll know it. Okay, 50% is the prevalence rate in the current metropolitan cities in India, 50%, which is a dangerous number. So the C5, don't think C5 governs only the shoulder. C5 also governs the phrenic nerve. Phrenic nerve governs the diaphragm. Diaphragm governs the lower esophageal sphincter. It can cause GERD. Morning we were talking about GIRD, glenohumeral internal rotation deficit. This is GERD, gastroesophageal reflux disease. So it's a mechanical problem. Okay, the valve is needed to be closed. But when valve is loose, it will come up. Why valve is loose? Diaphragm is tone is low. Why diaphragm is low, tone is low? Phrenic nerve, which is coming from where? C3, C4, C5. Repeat one more time. C3, C4, C5 keeps you alive. Okay, when you meddle with the neck, you will get systemic problem as well. Okay, so all people are treating the foot for the gastric. You need to treat the neck for your gastric, because C5 shares the diaphragm to the shoulder as well. Okay. Anyway, this is the problem with the thing. If there is a problem in the pathway, the brain does not know that the problem is in the pathway. The brain knows it is coming from the shoulder. Okay, the brain wants the treatment in the shoulder, and patient will compel the doctor to treat in the shoulder. Okay, the problem is in the pathway. Let's say posterior, there's a disc bulge over here. You see there is a C3, C4, C4, C5 disc bulge, which can cause shoulder pain. But if this patient, because he's having shoulder pain, he'll do it, shoulder MRI, he will not do neck MRI. He'll do shoulder MRI. Shoulder MRI will show partial thickness tear. Surgeon may be thinking, oh, should we do the surgery or not? If you do the surgery, it's disastrous, because the pain is going to go worse, okay? Because the problem is coming from the shoulder. You see this axial view here. This is my patient, real patient of mine. Okay, he had severe shoulder pain, whereas the bulge was happening in the postlateral aspect of the disc, okay, which is severely compressing the exiting nerve, which causes the shoulder pain, okay? So you have to be very, very careful in treating the shoulder, and you need to rule out the neck, because there are so many reasons, there are so many types of disc bulges happening very, very unusually. So to be in the safer side, do this test. Simple test, okay? Put the patient in the supine lying, do a simple retraction, distraction. RS called as traction. Don't do that chiropractic traction, that's dangerous. Don't do that. Do gentle distraction. If that alters the pain, either immediately reducing or immediately increasing, that confirms, okay, it's coming from the neck. Okay, don't treat the shoulder then. If you treat also, there is no use. So that's because the distraction test has 95% sensitivity. Tremendous sensitivity. If it is positive, it is from the neck. That's all. Okay. Similarly, some people will come to you with the, if this reduces the pain, or if this increases the pain, where? Anywhere. It can be even here also. Anywhere it can increase the pain. Okay. Or if ULTD is positive, and there's a new test which is recently introduced, it's called the arm squeeze test. Just gently pick up the skin and squeeze the skin. Okay. You don't even have to press the muscle. If the skin is sensitive, that's cervical problem. Okay, you have to treat the cervical spine only. So additional clues are middle scapular pain, neck ROM restriction, tingling numbness. I always ask any patient's shoulder, do you have tingling numbness as well? Morning I'll get doctor. But it's okay, after that it will go away. No. For you it goes away, but for me I have to consider that. Because in the body there is no symptom which is random. Everything for a reason. Morning when 10 minutes I have back pain, after that I'm fine. No, in the future you'll get severe back pain. Morning back pain, morning stiffness in the back, morning neck stiffness in the neck, is the indication that you are going to get one big attack in the future. You should wake up in the morning, you should feel like feather. That is the human body. Okay, if you're waking with stiffness, already telling you that there is a problem in the body. So anyway, for the easy understanding, I have classified the shoulder problem like this. Classify. If you treat everything as the same way, you won't get anywhere. You have to subclassify the conditions. What is discogenic pain? What is radicular pain? What is tendon pain? What is non-mechanical pains? You need to classify. So you can classify it as a painful shoulder, stiff shoulder, weak shoulders, unstable shoulder, and vascular shoulder. I got patient with DVT, you need to do a bit, see, physios, at least you need to know the red flags. You need to know how to diagnose the red flags as well. Don't just keep on treating them. You may actually cause them a pulmonary embolism. Okay, how much it is important to treat a patient with frozen shoulder? Same importance is to be given to rule out a patient with a DVT so that you refer them correctly. Okay, so those are the classifications. You can have it for your reference. And whatever shoulder classification you do, make sure you first rule out the neck, because 30 to 40% of the shoulder pain is from the neck. Okay, and then rule out the red flags. Now these are the three, but thankfully, these are the three common reasons why I get patients in my clinic with shoulder pain. This is by order in my understanding, in my clinical experience. First, the most common condition is frozen shoulder, which is primary, inflammatory, secondary mechanical. The second common is cervical shoulder pain. And the third common is the rotator cuff related shoulder pain, or you can put it under the umbrella called subacromial pain syndrome. In that syndrome, you can put tendinitis, tendon tear, bursitis, calcific tendinitis, okay, anything you can put under that, but these are all contractile problem. Do understand the third one is a contractile problem, okay? But life is not easy. Again, we have a mixed type here. A frozen shoulder patient will have a concomitant neck pain. Life is hell for them, because when they already have a neck pain, radiating down, plus frozen shoulder, they will not improve easily. Okay, these are the people who wanted the injections. These are the people who will have the pain even for that stipulated 1.5 to 2 years. These are people who want that surgery because the pain will not go away. Okay? And sometimes the tendon tear can be mixed. There will be a tendon tear, at the same time they'll have a cervical problem. So surgeon will do a surgery, but pain will not go away. Okay, surgeon will keep on saying, do exercise, do rehab, patient will come to us, doctor told to do rehab, but pain won't go away because you're not treating the neck correctly. Okay, so especially when the, let's say when there's a nerves are irritated, the tendons hurt more. I repeat, when the nerves are irritated, the tendons hurt more. Okay, so reduce the nerve compression, the tendons will hurt less. It happens, it applies to even tennis elbow, decurrence, as well as in the supraspinatus tendinitis. So what are the inflammation? So this is about the common reasons for the pain. And inflammatory, what is inflammatory pain? How do you know it's inflammatory pain? These people will have pain in the night time, resting pain, pain during movement, tenderness and warmth, with positive history of trauma or a history of inflammatory disorders like RA or SLE or something like that. Okay, so inflammatory pain you need to pick up. And then tendinitis, partial thickness, tear, full thickness, do understand, tendinitis is a clinical diagnosis. You don't need an X-ray or MRI for that. If the drop-off test is positive with the pain here, that's clinical diagnosis of tendinitis. Just give them the required treatment, which is unloading, and then gradually you can strengthen the muscle, but first unload them. Partial thickness and the full thickness tears are a radiological diagnosis. You cannot clinically diagnose someone's tendon is torn or not without doing an MRI. Okay, but if it is needed, you do it, but unnecessarily, we don't have to do. You see, you even if it is a partial thickness tear, you treat it like a tendinitis because the treatment is almost the same. Isn't it? Is it different? No, it's the same, almost. But sometimes you'll be surprised to know that the patient's tendon is fully torn, wherein his pain will improve. Okay, so there are so many complexities will happen. So rotator cuff arthropathy is a radiological diagnosis. Now, if you see, not all tendons will be
down.
Not all tendons will hurt as much. If you see this patient, he is using 2 kg dumbbell and doing abduction. No. There is no eccentric drop. There is no compensation. There is no shrugging happening. But if you see his MRI, you see here the
down.
There is no tendon only there. The supraspinatus is fully gone. 50% of infraspinatus and subscapularis is gone. How in this world this fellow is doing this? We don't know. Because 50% of the strength is given by subscapularis. Even if 25 to 30% of the subscapularis is preserved, someone can manage to do it. But the question is, how long you'll be able to preserve it? So that's why you have to do a little bit of load management and a little bit of strength training and a little bit of activity modification. If he's a farmer and he ducks digging and then throwing, then probably you must be advising him to prevent a full massive tear of all the three tendons. Once all the three tendons are torn, then you can't do it, okay? So why I'm saying this is, see, why it is not paining for him much? Tendon is fully torn, it's a surgical criteria. Because somebody's tendon tear will not pain, like ACL tear. ACL is torn, after 1 year, it won't pain. Isn't PCL is torn, after 1 year, it won't pain. Only instability will be there, but pain may not be there. Do you understand? So somehow the body will compensate, and someone's body can be inflammatory wise very good. Okay, gifted inflammation. Okay, so these people will not really have pain. This lady, 30-year-old, little obese lady, in Bangalore, I come from Bangalore, so the gym culture is nowadays is so much that every female is not going to the kitchen, they are going to the gym, and then doing the workouts, burpees, kirpees and all they do. And then this lady did something, and then she torn her labrum. and she never knew that the labrum is, if you see here, the labrum is torn. She never knew that it's a labrum. She was going to physiotherapy after physiotherapy after physiotherapy, 6 months over, 7 months over, 10 months over. She didn't get better. Do understand, you can't cure everybody in one form of treatment. Sometimes surgery is needed, sometimes surgery is not needed. Sometimes physiotherapy is only needed, sometimes just load management is needed. So you need to choose what is the right treatment. So you cannot keep on exercising and give all our modalities, laser, that, this and all, without understanding the nature of the problem. So this lady had to be operated because if you see there, because of the labral tear, there's a cyst formation. And that cyst was actually quite big. That was compressing the nearby structures that was causing the pain. The moment the cyst was removed and the labrum was corrected, now the patient is okay. It's been almost 3 months after the surgery. The patient is doing well, but she's not going to gym yet. She's a little scared. But what I'm saying is that sometimes you can't diagnose. Because if it's not fitting into your criteria, just refer them for the scan. You will at least get some answers. At least if there's no problem, assure the patient. See, there's no problem. Carry on. There's no problem as such. Pain is there. We'll deal with that. But when there's a problem, don't delay. Get the surgery done or whatever has to be done. Okay? So, that's a characteristic of the labral pain. See, it can be coming from the frozen shoulder or the labrum or the slap, or like biceps tendon or the muscles or the tendons. So categories like that. Is it labral problem? Is it a slap problem? Is it a capsular problem? Is it a neck problem going to the shoulder? So without you subcategorizing people, because human beings are heterogeneous. Human beings are what? Heterogeneous. You cannot give one form of treatment to everybody. Everybody are different. Same treatment will not work for everybody. So the labral characteristics are deep-seated pain. They say pain is deep, doctor. Not outside, inside, deep. Between the Corcoran process and the greater tuberosity, and if it is an anterior labral tear, the pain will be deep, and they'll have better eccentric control. You give them 1 kg weight, ask them to descend, they'll have better eccentric control because it's not a contractile problem. It's just a labral problem, okay? And then they'll be having occasional clicks and clunks. Little bit of sound here and there with or without the pain. Pain during the end range, let's say you do this, you see this maneuver, you know, okay, Hawkins Kennedy. See, end range. It compresses the labrum. So these are some of the ways by which you understand the labrum. Special test here and there is usual, but special test alone is not useful. You need to do a clinical clustering of what I said. So whatever I used, clinical clustering for certain conditions, use the same cluster. Make your own cluster for all the conditions so that you can be a champion in your diagnosis. Okay. But if labral tear cannot be confirmed without the MRI, MRI or MRI arthrogram is needed. Now, other influencing factors of pain, it's not only that. You have to understand the biological makeup, inherent inflammatory tendency, neuronal circuit. There are so many, the neural circuits are different. For someone, the C5 now will go up to downwards C6 and C7. For someone, the C5 will go up to C6. In the spinal cord level, there are so many miscommunications may happen that makes everybody's pain is unique. Okay, so the neural circuit, the discerning pain inhibitory mechanism, and the psychosocial aspect all should be considered and understand that the pain is unique. Okay, now as a healthcare professional, how do we do better? Now, do understand the complexity of the problem.
So last 2 minutes?
Yeah. Do understand the complexity of the problem. I know that it's complex, but I always try to do a diagnosis. Structural pathoanatomical or the structural diagnosis. Because as I said, no symptom is random. If someone is having a numbness in the last toe, it's a symptom. It cannot be, something. It could be something. It could be something, weakness. So these are all the assumptions and presumptions people do, and then they belittle their problem, okay? Identify the pain generator, identify the pain generator and pain type, okay, and never ignore the cervical. Whenever you're seeing even the lumbar pain, no? See, knee pain, you need to check the back. How do you check the neck for the shoulder pain? Okay, because the nerves can be like that. Never ignore the cervical spine when you are treating the shoulder, and never ignore the lumbar pain when you treat the knee or the buttock, okay, and do clinical clustering for better diagnosis. Do diagnose every condition. Okay, patients come to you with symptom, it's our job, our onus, responsibility to make a diagnosis. So do a clinical clustering for a better diagnosis and avoid treating the referred pain area, treat the source. Referred pain is actually a misleading thing. Don't go by the referred pain area. Patient will compel you to give the IFT here. Okay, give the IFT here, it's paining here, but it's referred pain. It feels nice, no doubt in that. You put heart pack, it feels nice. But feeling nice is different from getting cured. Okay, all this amujadan, jandu bomb, what you put in the night, is it curing your headache? That particular night, it's comfortable, that's all. But it never cures anybody's headache or migraine. So physical habits, lifestyle, metabolic health, and neuroinflammatory factors govern the pain. Little bit about the metabolic health, because people are having very poor metabolic health now. Most of my classmates are having diabetes and BP now in their 40s. So that poor metabolism will cause more glycemic load. More sugar means more inflammation. More inflammation means more stickiness. The same stickiness happens in the coronary artery, same stickiness happens in the capsule. That's why diabetic people are more prone for the front shoulder. So talk to them about metabolic health, weight reduction, and then the exercises and low carbohydrate diet. So that's how we comprehensively treat the patients, understand the pain, treat the biology, and consider the psychology. Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you, sir. That was a very informative talk.
Yeah.
Any questions, guys? Any questions?
Yeah.
Give him a mic, please.
Sir, in one example, you shown a patient's video that a torn supraspinatus patient, he was lifting the shoulder with the help of subscapularis. In that kind of patient, what kind of advice we have to give?
We will explain them that somehow you are God gifted. Okay, preserve what you have, strengthen what you have, but not at the not with the like the strengthen meaning not like doing 1 RM or 80% of 1 RM. The tendency is age is about 55 years or something. Okay, as you get older, the tendons will get degenerated. Okay, and it won't have the same tensile strength as the young guy. So for such people, we will give the exercise which is less than 50% of their 1 RM or maximum strength. So that is easily achieved by a simple TheraBand, or maybe for him you can do maybe 1 kg or 1.5 kg dumbbell to maintain it, because without exercise it will degenerate faster because it doesn't get blood supply. So it's like a double-edged sword, exercise is. You know how many patients I get after the gym workout? Burpees, back pain, exercise is a double-edged sword. If you over-exercise and harm yourself, you become a painful patient. And first, with that pain, what fitness, what you will achieve with the fitness with when you're having the severe pain? So first painlessness and then the fitness. So what I say is, you give the exercise in a way, it is stimulating the tendon growth, at the same time doesn't break the tendon, which is usually 40 to 50% of the one repetition maximum. You have to measure, so roughly if it is a 50-year-old man, you can predict that it could be about 3.2 kg to 3 kg max, that's all. Beyond that, if you give, it will tear. Plus, more than that, I think this guy is a degenerative tear. What is degenerative tear? He didn't know that when he torn his tendon. Okay, it's not a traumatic tear like he fell down from the bike and then immediately I got the shoulder pain. Slowly it progresses. So degenerative tears will be usually painless compared to the traumatic tears. So such people, degenerative tear people doesn't need surgery. They with conservative they get managed. But only thing is avoid like this and then this workout, that will create shear stress. Okay, so what LV says, the scapular plane, that too short liver, fabulous, you can do it. Okay, and don't sleep on the same side, that to some extent that will compress the joint more. Okay, so activity modification, load management, and strengthening exercise.
Okay, sir, thank
yeah.
you.
Thank you, sir. Any other questions? Yeah.
Hello. Sir, I am Vel Murugan from Athur. ஒரு ஜென்ரலான க்வெஸ்சன் என்னென்னா, நீங்கள் ஒருவேளை அதை படிச்சிருப்பீங்கன்னு நினைக்கிறேன். அந்த காலத்தில் இந்த மாதிரி நிறையா மக்களுக்கு இந்த மாதிரி இல்லை. இப்போ இருக்க ஜென்ரேஷனுக்கு இந்த மாதிரி பிஎஸ் சொல்கிற நிறைய பேர்த்துக்கு வருது, கிராமத்து மக்களுக்கு கூட வருது. இதை வந்து நம்ம ட்ரீட்மெண்ட்டாக பண்ணாமல் ஒரு லைஃப் ஸ்டைலாக இதை வர வைக்காமல் நம்ம என்ன சொல்லலாம் மக்களுக்கு?
ஓகே, I understood the question. Can I answer in English if it's okay with you? Can I answer in English? Okay.
Also Tamil.
So you want me to answer in Tamil?
Okay. Okay.
Okay.
Both
are. Okay. 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 I'm comfortable in English because there are some other non-Tamil speaking people out there. So the question is now, why suddenly everyone is sick? Okay. Why humans are becoming sick? Yes, why frozen shoulder in such young age? I see people, 35-year-old ladies and all getting frozen shoulder, even village people. You see that, no, even in village, sugar is there. It's not like, you know, village, only in cities the people are having sugar. Okay, even in village people are, because our the moment we started doing agriculture, which is for the past 10,000 years only we are doing agriculture revolution. And once we started doing agriculture, we grown carbohydrates. Before the 20 lakhs years, we were all hunter-gatherers. We are just eating whatever is there. That time what we have, we eat it. So predominantly our diet was mostly proteins and a little bit of carbohydrates here and there, whichever season that fruit comes. Apple season, you eat apple. Grape season, we eat grape. But now, the season is not there for the fruits. Every season, every fruit is available. That's one thing. Plus too much of carbohydrate loading. We are eating this much rice every day. Okay. And that carbohydrate load, our body is not able to tolerate. 20 lakh years of genetic adaptation by our metabolism, past 10,000 years of glycemic overload, especially for the past 10 years, we have so much of food. Okay. 20 years back, my grandmother asked me to eat more because I'm very lean like that. You go to school, which kid is lean now? Everyone is like this. So it's very sick that everyone is eating too much of carbohydrate load, too much of metabolic health. That's why people are dying out of heart attack. I came out today from the airport. The board, KG Hospital Cardiac Surgery Unit, best class, world class facility. This side, KMC Hospital Cardiac Surgery. Man, I'm coming to Coimbatore first time. See, you got it. That means what? Everyone is having metabolic problem. Metabolic problem causes BP and sugar. BP is a symptom, it's not a diagnosis. So BP and sugar and all the diabetes, these are all due to poor eating style, I would say, not lifestyle, poor eating style. Okay, that if you have to change, anyway, it's a little out of scope. I did a webinar on metabolic health, you just asked me the link, I'll send. To summarize, do exercise 4 times a day, 4 times, everybody knows. It's a physio who doesn't do the exercise, they teach others to do the exercise. So do exercise and maintain the metabolic health and eat less. Even if you exercise very heavily, your bad diet will still kill you. Okay, you cannot run with your bad diet. Okay, diet should be good, which is 90% of your metabolic health. Little bit of exercise you have to add. Okay. Any other questions?
So I have one question for you. Now, when we look at the PA shoulder or a stiff shoulder, how much of the contribution is from the mechanoreceptors, and how much of the contribution is coming from the nociceptors?
Excellent.
And what will be your choice, whether to work not influencing the mechanoreceptors or to suppress the nociceptors?
Okay. Let me ask this way. In the normal shoulder, without a frozen shoulder, the capsule is supposed to tell your brain its position. It has to appraise the brain how it's moving, how much it can stretch, how much it cannot stretch. So capsule is primarily 80% is mechanoreceptors because it is important for proprioception. Okay, but once the capsule is shrunk with a inflammatory, it becomes first inflammation and then it will become contraction. Once it becomes contraction inflamed, new blood vessels grow there. New nerves, it's called as neurogenesis, new nerves grow there, and all these nerves and the blood vessels will intertwine and make that area like that. Little bit you move, these nerves will stretch until, hey, why are you disturbing me? So that time it becomes a nociceptor. So in normal shoulder, it's predominantly mechanoreceptors, but in frozen shoulder, it's predominantly nociceptors. But still you need to do the stretching only, because if 90% of the frozen shoulders, pain management you can do with physiotherapy only. Remaining 10%, they need MUA or arthroscopic scapular release. Okay. 90%, especially the early you identify, early you treat, in 7 sessions you can fix it. Then when they come to you with frozen stage, second stage, you need at least 15 to 25 sessions to fix them. But tell the patient it needs that much time. They don't expect, 2 days you come, I do one chiropractic technique, the movement will improve. If it is improving like that immediately, it is not frozen shoulder. That's a different diagnosis. If it is not, if it is a frozen shoulder, it should not improve immediately. So if someone claiming that they will improve in one day, they are either bluffing you or it's not a frozen shoulder. So for your question, it's predominantly mechanoreceptors for the normal shoulder. But once it becomes a frozen shoulder, it's predominantly nociceptors. Okay. Okay, thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. Next, I call Deepak Pradhan on stage. He's an assistant professor from Abhinabindra Sports Medicine and Research Institute. And he's from ABTP Bhuvaneshwar team.
So, am I audible to all? And thank you so much for the intro. And I am very much thankful for the organization team for having me here as a speaker. And special thanks to Dr. Paul and Dr. Ganesan for helping me here. And this will be the last session of this event. So I will not take much of your time, and I will try to make it colorful as it looks, and try to make it more of interesting. So the topic is technology-based shoulder rehabilitation. So as you have spoken many things since the morning, like what is the shoulder. So like there is something called, you know, as a human, we cannot be at every time we can give our best. At every time we cannot give our best. So that time or that some point of time, we should be taking help of the technologies. So how the technologies can be useful in rehabilitation. So that I'll be talking today. So the next slide, what I'm going to see, this is my contents. So what I'll be talking about myself and why technology is so important in the today's era. Then the shoulder complex, little bit about the biomechanics I'll be talking, and the Troyer's paradox. And second thing will be coming my technologies. So whatever things are there in the, you know, yeah. So the things what are there in the blue picture, the blue line, they are the platforms. These technologies are known as the platform-based technologies. And the white colors are, they are more of the devices. So these are like basic technologies what I'll be talking. And then at the end, how to rehabilitate it using the technologies. And my takeaway messages will be. So coming to the next slide here. So this is me, myself, and this is my workplace where I work. And this is my lab where we do most of the researches and the studies. Okay. So next, moving on to the evolution. So just have a look how the humans were and how they were now, the current humans. So they have evolved. Similarly, if you talk about the technologies, like earlier days, how used to have communication with the help of this phone, right? Next, it came to small Nokia phone. Nokia phone and some kind of phone it used to come, the keypad phone what you call. Next, now we are using iPod, the iPhone, and the next generation will be the handphone, the future technology. So that is how the technology is being evolved. So in the today's era, if you are using this Graham Bell phone or the Nokia mobile phone, will it be useful on communicating with all the people? No, definitely not. So that is why we need to evolve with the technologies, what is coming to the new. Okay, so next, coming to the physiotherapy, so how the technology has improved. So if you talk about strengthening exercises, so if you're talking of strengthening exercises, usually we're giving off knee, do the movement of the knee, so active movement you do, or you do with weight, the things will get improved, the strength will get improved. Next, what it came, like your the knee extension machine, what had it come. Next, now what are you using, the dynamometer. So knee extension, what you could not do, like, there are different phases of strengthening. So there are two biomechanical points I would like to tell, like the upper limb muscles and the lower limb muscles. In terms of force production, the upper limb muscles are more powerful in the middle range. If you talk about bicep can produce more torque, more force in the middle range. But if you talk about lower limb muscles, they are more, torque production in the lower range, the outer range. If you talk about football kicking, you are using your lower limb muscles in the outer range. So there is a biomechanical difference between different ranges of muscles. So upper limb muscles are more of powerful in the middle range, and your lower limb muscles are more powerful in the outer range. So that this technology could not do. This technology, what are you seeing here, the boy with the leg machine, it could not happen, the limitations had. So that is why the isokinetic devices come. So the isokinetic devices, what it can do, it can create linear or the required resistance can be given by this machine or by this equipment, which will behave a uniform resistance for strengthening purpose. That is how the technology has evolved. So next, coming to the, so if you have a good technologies, you should remember this famous movie. So could you please tell the movie name, what it is? Chris. So like they have told about future technology, future computer, right? So we should be, the future computer will be telling us what is going to happen in the future. Similarly, the technologies what I will be talking in this my upcoming slides, it will tell us what is going to happen. The future you can get to know from these technologies. Okay? And these technologies can make us proactive rather than becoming a reactive. So can anyone just tell me what is the difference between proactive person and a reactive person? Proactive and reactive. Proactive and reactive. Like a simple example. Suppose today early morning you got up and you had a predefined that there will be conference today. But if you would have thought of like there is chances of raining. So if you would have a proactive person, you would have carried an umbrella with you. But you would have a reactive person, what you would do? Let's the rain, then we'll see what it can be done. So that is called reactive. So it is always to become a proactive rather than becoming reactive. Proactive means you know the risks are going to come. So how you can prepare yourself, and reactive means when the risk comes, so you will be preparing yourself. So technologies can make us reactive rather than proactive. Next, coming to the shoulder complex biomechanics, what I would like to say, the shoulder joint, it is more of a mobility versus stability complex. If you look about the joint complex, the humerus bone and the scapula bone, the humerus bone, it is high, the head of the humerus size is twice than your scapula, the glenoid cavity of the scapula. So despite of this stability complex, the shoulder joint is stable. Despite of this articular compromises in the stability complex, the shoulder joint provides stability as well as mobility. So when a throwers want to throw a ball or with the help of a shoulder, so what is happening here, simultaneously the stability has to get maintained and by the same time the mobility has to come. So by maintaining the stability, you need to generate the mobility. So that is how the shoulder joint works. So there has to be a balance between stability and mobility. Okay, next, coming about little bit of biomechanics, like what you have, if you had a BPD student, you would have known what is this, like this is more of your, synthanarchine biomechanics. So if you could see like force X and force Y, what it is comes here, some force X, it is parallel to the long X of the humerus, and the force Y, it is perpendicular to the long X of the humerus. So the basic rule is, the force which is parallel, it creates a translation. And the force which is perpendicular, it creates a rotation. So the rotation forces creates a instability and translation forces create stability. That is a basic biomechanics what I've studied so far. So what happens in the shoulder joint movement, there is always a force couple movement. There is always a force couple movement. Okay, so when two forces are acting together, the resultant force is coming. So that is how it is happening in the shoulder complex. Like when the translatory forces are becoming more, the the humerus head migrates superiorly, so it might impinge the superior structure. That is what we call it as a shoulder impingement syndrome. So why the shoulder impingement syndrome happens? Because of this overactivation of this picture. Because of this overactivation of this image, okay, and underactivation of this force couple. So there must be a balance between the rotatory force and the translatory force to reduce the or to minimize the impingement. Okay. Next, coming to the muscles, how we can classify the muscles around the shoulder complex. So there are different muscles are there in the shoulder complex. So how we can basically classify into? So you can basically classify axioscapular muscles, like and scapulohumeral muscles and axiohumeral muscles. So what axioscapular muscle does, like if you talk about a shoulder joint movement, it is composed of three bones, the humerus, the scapula and the clavicle. So the axioscapular muscles, they help to enhance your clavicle and scapular mobility. Whereas your scapulohumeral muscles, they help to maintain stability either during static or during dynamic phase. Okay, and your axiohumeral muscles, what they do, they help to get a added movement or the they help to get a total arc of movement. When you talk in case of swimmers, they have to do a 360 degree of movement. So that time the latissimus dorsi has to act, or end range flexion, the pectoralis major has to act. So these are the muscles which are considered as a exohumeral muscle. So this is how you can classify the shoulder group of muscles. So rather than you should be knowing what are the functional classification of the muscle for the shoulder complex. Next, coming to the technology. The first technology is the dynamometer. So as Dr. Paul has mentioned, the importance of dynamometer, what it can do. So dynamometer is a device. Dynamometer is a device which can measure the muscle torque production or the muscle force production. So it can be a device or it can be a fixed form. It can be a fixed frame or it can be a device. So what it is going to do, with the help of this, we are in an overhead athlete, we are going to record the torque production of internal rotator muscle and torque production of external rotator muscles. Okay. So when during the loading phase, when someone wants to throw something, your external rotators and internal rotators go for loading. But when you want to release the ball, the loading changes, like the internal motors go for eccentric loading and some muscles go for concentric loading. So the strength balance or the strength imbalance can lead to injury. So how we can use, so these are the sports, how we can use it. One second. So this is what you can see, like during the release spell of the Dalston, when he is bowling, when he is about to release the ball, there must be a balance between his shoulder internal rotator and his external rotator. The shoulder internal rotator and external rotator strength has to be balanced. And similarly, the loading phase of Novak Djokovic, when he is about to serve a tennis serve, there must be a balance between your shoulder anterior muscles as well as posterior muscles. If this doesn't happen, I mean if the strength alteration happens, that can lead to injury. So this device can tell us whether the athlete will have an injury in the future or not. Okay, so this is the report what we get originally from the device or the fixed frame devices if you go for that. Next, yes, so some studies it has shown like what should be the ratio internal rotation torque or the external rotation torque. So this can be used in various sports like bowling, while making a smash or while making a spike. So all these sports you can make use of that is technologies. So what the evidence has found that shoulder internal rotation and external rotation torque production, pre-season external rotation strength and in-season injury. So if an athlete during the off-season, if he has lack of external rotator strength, that is going to cause in-season injury. So that is what you can make use of these technologies and predict your injury pattern of your athlete. So in the off-season, if he has less strength or is there a strength imbalance between your internal rotator and the external rotator, that is going to cause your injury in the on-season. And hip and scapular muscle fatigue, as you have since the morning you are talking about, you know, like kinetic chain. So like that is the scapular muscles, lack of scapular muscle strength or lack of hip muscle strength, that also can have impact on the force production on the shoulder. So that is how you can make out from these technologies, like what is the torque production of the hip and the shoulder, particularly while having a upper limb movement or throwing activity. Okay, next. These are a few evidences what I have gathered, what is supporting to these devices or these technologies. Okay. Next, coming to the ISO-SIFT. So ISO-SIFT, it is composed of a inertia. There are two things what you can see. There is something called a platform is there. So this platform, it is an inertia-based platform. And the second thing, it has some upper limb kinetics, upper limb movement. So along with this platform, you can do some upper limb movements. Okay. So the platform will tell you how much the stability is. How much the stability is, because when you want to have a proper throw, you need to have a proper stability. If you do not have a proper stability in your leg, definitely you cannot generate a force from your upper limb. So you need to have a stability for that. So this platform is going to tell how much stability you have while performing your upper limb task. While performing your upper limb task, how much stability you have. You might have stability in a double leg stance position. When I ask you to stand in a static position, you might have strength. But when I am asking you to do some activity, throw a ball, then what is the strength changes happens? So that you can get to know from this platform. Okay. And the upper limb activities, how it can be used, like you could see some sports. So these are the sports or they are the movements of sport where the diagonal pattern acts. So when some movement is going to happen, it is we call it functional movement pattern. So the brain doesn't recognize as that the movement or the force should produce from a single muscle or from a single joint. It is a series of muscles. It is a chain of muscles, how they are getting activated during a particular activity. Like in the physios, if you could have known of the PNF pattern, how the PNF pattern muscles are getting activated during a particular task. So this, the upper limb devices will, like with the use of the upper limb devices in the ISO-SIFT, you can get to know what is the force production pattern during a functional movement. During a having performance of a functional movement, you will get to know what is the strength of that. So that the technology is going to tell us. So this can be used either in case of tennis, like while making a tennis serve or making a delivering a ball or throwing a ball, like during different kind of athletes, you can take this technologies, make use of it. Next, the report, what are you going to get? So in the first picture, equilibrium, what are you going to see? What are you going to see? The equilibrium here is a COP. Okay, so in the equilibrium, what it comes like? The red mark. So red mark, it comes more of a posterior. So when the athlete stands, if he leans more of posteriorly, then the red mark is going to come more of a posteriorly. So while maintaining the balance, he is using more of his back muscles rather than usually while maintaining the balance, we must be using equal contribution from our front muscle as well as the back muscle. But in this athlete, what the report is saying, he is compensating his balance with more of activation of your posterior chain group of muscles. So he might have tightness in the posterior group of muscles. What is the report says here? Okay, and what you could see that the equilibrium in the diagonal pattern, what you could see the green picture versus the red picture. So that it says that what is the movement pattern. So controlled movement pattern will have a single line. If you could see like the green line versus the red line. So the green line is more scattered and the red line is more centered. So more of the centered force production has more controlled force production. And more is a deviation from the center line that is called uncontrolled movement. So controlled movement and uncontrolled movement pattern that you can also identify through these technologies. Okay. Next, again, these are the upper limb test reports what it is shown here. Next, there is something called the postural bed or the T bed. What is this postural bed or T bed? Like in the regular assessment of an athlete, we do postural assessment, how the posture is. Okay, so we are talking of forward head posture. We are talking of your lateral bending of spine, the scoliosis. We are talking of lordotic posture. We are talking of kyphotic posture. So here we are talking more on the joint range. How much flexion is there at the thoracic spine? How much lateral bending there is the entire spine? How much flexion or how much forward translation there is the cervical spine? That is what the kinematic data we are getting. But what about the muscle? How much muscle loading is happen, that nobody, we are not getting any data for that. When you are assessing a posture, especially, and we are commenting about that this is the, movement pattern, this much of, like how do you measure forward head posture? Cranio-vertebral angle. How do you measure scoliosis? Cobb's angle. So this tells you only about the how much angulation he has. But what is the muscle activation pattern? Suppose I am having a forehead posture. So what is the muscle activation pattern of my right side versus left side? That data I do not have. So this postural bed can tell us what is the muscle force production or muscle tension production. Like if you talk about right-handed player versus a left-handed player. So or a dominant hand versus non-dominant hand. So definitely the dominant side of the body will have more strength than the non-dominant side, but how much should be the difference? Like if you, there is a significance of a non-dominant head as well. Like if you talk about the cricket bowling. So cricket bowling, you bowl with right handed, but what is the significance of left hand? So based on the action of the left hand, there is a force generation. Similarly, when you make a loading phase for making a serve or making a spike, there is a importance of your non-dominant or the, non-serving hand as well. So this is what the strength imbalance can have influence on the performance. So what is the strength imbalance between your right side and the left side of the body in different segments, so that you can get to know from the this postural bed. So this postural bed, what are you going to check? You are going to check the muscle imbalance pattern in different positions, like in the 180 degree position and in the 120 degree position. Okay, so this is going to tell you the reports. What the report will be? See, it is like the right side versus the left side, what the strength changes occur. So if you look at the scapular region, it is like 26% if you see it is right side, it is, left side you can see it is more of a 50.3% and right side it is 49.7%. There is a difference between muscle strength production, but this is not a large difference what you could say. Then lumbar region, what you could see? There is a lumbar region, there is a, again, big difference comparative to your scapular region. Next, coming to your thigh region. Thigh region, it is more of 52% and 47%. Again, it is more of difference. Okay, so that is what you are going to get. What is the muscle imbalance pattern? Okay, so this muscle imbalance pattern also you can get from the postural bed or the T bed technologies. Like, as a physio, so we are more into functional diagnosis. We are more into functional diagnosis. We are not more into structural diagnosis, because every time we cannot depend upon the structural diagnosis. We should find out the what is the functional impairment. So the functional impairment or the functional diagnosis, to have a functional diagnosis, you can make use of your T-bed technologies to identify the muscle force production of different segments of the body and two sides of your body, right versus left. I mean dominant versus non-dominant side. Next, coming to the Prokin stabilometric platform. So what is the stabilometric platform? Stability. So you can make, or you can, you will get information on the stability. What is the stability? Like stability means, suppose I am standing here with a like partial squatting. This is a stable surface. But if the surface gets moved, surface is moving, like in a, like if you like the, you know, that what you call the balance board. If you stand on a balance board and you try to try to make your balance, so what is the strength production or what is the force production in that, that the stabilometric platform can tell us. Okay, and the right side there is something called pelvic stabilometer. So what this pelvic stabilometer says, what is the role of hip or pelvis? Because the core muscle, what are you talking of, core is not only limited to your abdomen area, it is also related to, there is something called hip core, which is very much important in the athlete. Hip core versus abdominal core. So the pelvic stabilometer is going to tell about what is the strength of your hip core. Okay, and this will tell you about during a partial squat position with different directions, like if you're moving in the anterior direction or posterior direction, lateral direction or a square direction, what is the strength differences. Suppose the athlete might have a good strength in a static position of the partial squat, but he might not have a good strength in the anterior direction or in the posterior direction. So that the technologies can tell us. Next, why, how it can be used, like you can see the stance of Kevin Peterson, how he makes a stance, big stance. So when he makes a stance, there must be a balance between his right leg and left leg should produce equal balance. And same time, his pelvic core also has to get activated. So with a proper stance only, he can generate, with a proper technique, he can make an effective shot. So many of the coaches, they might have known, or if you have more of batting, I mean technical batting, not this modern day batting, what you come and hit, that is not the batting I call, like the technical batting, what you call, like I would say the Indian coach Rahul Dravid, how he bats, or like, you know, Ajinkya Rahane, how he bat, there are more of technical players. So those kind of technical players, stance make a very good, very important factor on delivering a shot. So while making a stance, he is maintaining a partial squat position. So what is the strength difference while moving in different direction that you can get from the stabilometric platform? Or there is something called while making, you know, while playing off your badminton, when you are waiting, when opponent is serving, you should maintain this position with the racket. You should maintain a half squat position. So with your arm abducted and your flexed and slight up horizontal abducted. So here what are you supposed to do? You have to hold the racket. So whichever position your shuttle is going to come, you are going to hit it. So here also stance is important. So the stance you can make, or like if you could see the right top right picture here, the tennis player is waiting for the opponent serve to come. So you can get, you can know the importance of stance, how much importance it is on having the performance. So the stance and the pelvic stability you can get to know from the stabilometric platform. And this is the report what are you going to get. And the report what it tells, if like if you could see, like there is something called, you know, yeah, there is something called the green lines and the red lines. So if it is more centered, how much centered it will be, that much good coordination or good balance it will be. If it deviates from the center, that we call it the ellipse area. If the ellipse area is more, if the ellipse area is moving away from the center, then the balance is less. If the ellipse area is more towards the center, then we will say the balance is good. Okay. Next, there is something called, yeah, the reports of that. Next, there is something called digital wall, the D wall. So if you go to like the G image what I have put, so what you can get to know, the upper limb strength endurance. The strength and endurance of the upper limb can be measured by using D-wall, and at the same time you can use the agility of the upper limb. The upper limb agility and the upper limb strength and endurance can be measured. So in the upper limb strength and endurance, he is going to do the number of push-ups during a 15 second or during a 30 second. Okay, and he is going to perform a certain task, like he is going to touch the ball with by changing the position. This is called upper limb agility, and upper limb strength and endurance can be checked through digital wall platform. So digital wall platform, it is not only limited to your shoulder. I mean diagnosis. It can be used for entire body. It is always otherwise called a dynamic platform. So it can be used for very, very dynamic purpose. You can use for jump, you can use for stability, you can use for inertia, you can use for force platform, you can use for your upper limb strength, endurance power. So for many purposes, D-Well can be used. And apart from that, the D-Well can design some exercises. Basic exercises it can design according to the impairment the individual is having. Based on that, the rehabilitation can be progressed. Okay, so this is the last picture what I had shown. It is like during the jump performances, how it is coming. Okay, next, coming to, there is something called QT index. So the QT index is going to tell about what is the overall performances. So these are the tests which we can measure from your D-Well platform. So the QT index score will tell the overall platform. As we have, again, I'll be repeating the kinetic chain aspect. It is all linked. Your wrist is linked to your feet, like what the sir has told, like he has put a needle on the feet and his trapezius pain got resolved. So this is all a kinetic chain, it is got linked to it. So while making a performance or while assessing a performance, we need to assess the entire body rather than only a specific body part. So this D-Well platform can tell us about what is the overall body performances in specific in terms related to the athletes. Okay. Next, there is something called heart rate monitor devices. So what is this heart rate monitor devices? Like it will tell something about heart rate variability. How much, what is the rate of variability of the heart rate, the fluctuation? Higher the fluctuation, lesser the performances will be. If the heart rate fluctuation is more, then the performance is going to get affected. So the heart rate monitor devices, which is being worn by many athletes nowadays during the time of play, so that can give a hint about what is the variability of the heart rate, how much the fluctuation is happening between the upper range and the lower range. So that can you get to know about the heart rate monitor devices. Okay, next, there are a few evidences for it. Next, there is something called interesting movement analysis, motion analysis. Nowadays, very much famous, it looks very much fancy. What is movement analysis? What is motion analysis? This is another technology what is being used. Okay, so this is the technologies, I mean, movement analysis of a baseball player, how he is pitching the ball. Next, there is something called, I'll be talking more of the movement analysis, the cricket fast bowling. Okay, the cricket fast bowling, the sir has told something about different phases of fast bowling. Okay, the coaches might know about it, but biomechanically you can divide into two phases, pre-deliver phase and the deliver phase. So pre-deliver phase lasts from the momentum to maintain, and deliver phase when it delivers the ball. So how the fast bowling happens, I can tell you, like first the run up happens. The athlete or the bowler tries to run. Then while running, he creates momentum. He creates momentum. Then from back foot to front foot contacts, he tries to maintain the momentum. So whatever momentum he has generated through the running, he has to maintain during the back foot to front foot contact. Then only that momentum can be used for delivering. So whatever momentum is achieved through the running phase, if that could not maintain from the back foot to front foot transition, then the deliver phase is going to get affected. So when a particular or a fast bowler comes with shoulder pain, you need to assess where the technical fault is. Whether the technical fault comes from the momentum phase, or it is from the transition phase, or from the deliver phase. So we need to identify biomechanically where is the fault. So that we can get to know from the motion analysis system. So I'll add a few videos for it. So if you could see, so could you make out from this graph, like there are three, I have put graphs of three athletes, athlete 1, 2, 3, athlete what is black, green, and yellow color. Okay, so if you could see the black athlete or the athlete number one, what is like during the pre-deliver phase, he develops a linear momentum. A linear momentum is getting generated, and that could able to maintain. He could able to maintain the momentum from the back foot to front foot contact. The athlete number one, and finally he delivered. Second, if you come about the your athlete number two, the green line, what does it indicate? The momentum was bit less comparable to the athlete number one, but somehow he could maintain the momentum. Somehow you could maintain the momentum, but you see the force production, it is more or less same to the athlete number one. So the force production, it is almost same for athlete number one and two. There is a small difference is there. But what difference, what does it signify? Like the athlete number two is generating more force in the deliver phase. But the athlete number one, he is generating equal force from the each of the phase. So the athlete two, we can call it is unorthodox bowler. It might be unorthodox athlete, or he is having some wrong technique. So that is what it signify. Next, coming to the athlete number three. So what does it signify? He could generate the momentum, but he could not maintain it. It got declined. But again, he could maintain the, he could deliver the speed. So this is what the different type of athlete, the graphical representation, how the force production changes according to the biomechanics, that you can get this all data, so you can get from a motion analysis system software. Okay, next let's talk about, like this already told in the morning, like how the kinetic chain system works. So kinetic chain system works from the lower limb, then it travels to the upper limb. So one more point I would like to add, which is missing here, like kinetic chain starts from the lower limb, delivers to the upper limb via trunk, isn't it? Okay, so the studies have shown that how much force is generated, that becomes a triple when delivering a ball. So how that force becomes a triple while delivering a ball? So if you could what I can show you, there was something called when you are a child, you must have played some game. There will be some stick, I don't know what you call that, like if you rotate that will fly. Could you remember it? If you could rotate it, it will fly. But if you throw it, it will not fly. So why it happens? Because of the rotational movement. So when the power is coming from your lower limb, when you add trunk rotation to it, the momentum gets doubled. When the power is coming from the lower limb, like when I made a front foot contact, the ground direction force gave me a force through my lower limb. And by adding the trunk rotation, my power becomes double. The power generation what I have achieved from the foot contact, that becomes double because of the additional of trunk rotation. So that is the significance of kinetic chain, significant the trunk motions in the kinetic chain. Okay, so I'll be talking a little bit of the rotational related sports later in this presentation. Okay, next let's have a video demonstration of different kind
this
of ballers.
African fast baller Dow Stein.
Mute the videos.
Stein is an example.
Mute. Yes. Just have a video of, have a look at the video and tell me what the difference what you could make. That's why I muted the video. Okay, so what is the biomechanical difference is the technique what they had. The technique what Delston had, we call it as front on technique. And the technique what Mitchell Stark had, we call it as side on technique. And could you remember what third bowler, who is he? No, third bowler. He is Australian fast bowler, James Pattinson. So he is a mixed on bowler. So data says, evidence says that mixed on bowlers will have more injuries compared to your side on and front on bowlers. And side on bowlers will have less injury compared to the front on and mixed on bowlers. Okay, side on bowlers who all are trained in the grassroots level. Those who are trained in the grassroots level, the proper technique, they will have a side on technique. And those who have learnt by themselves, they are more inclined to our front on technique. And mixed on, it is more of technical fault. There will march up a technical fault. Okay, so this is what that video says of. Next, there is something called, just have a look at video of Shaheen Shah Afridi. How does he bowl? Yes. So what is the difference of these two bowlers? Could you find out? This is Hines Apri, this is Delston, that you could make out, right? But the difference what they had during the front foot landing. During the front foot landing, if you could see, the Hines Apri, he is more of toe. He is touching his front toe. And Delston is touching his heel. So this is called proper technique and this is called improper technique. That is why most of the Pakistan bowlers nowadays, they just, you know, like rata rat mala mal jo bolte hai na, overnight they get famous. So, but they will not for long lasting because of this, they generate more force because of this improper technique. Because this improper technique, they generate more force, but that is not technically sound. So that is why they cannot continue for a long, they do not have a long standing career. But if you talk about Delston, he had a long standing career and he had an impactful career. So that is what, you need to have a good technical skills in terms of longevity in the sport. It is not like just you will play for one series or two series or just one tournament or only one World Cup. If you used to play for a longer period of time, you need to have a good technique. Okay. Next. So this is called, while the back foot landing, do you know Hardik Pandya? Which injury he had recently? What injury he had recently, Hardik Pandya? Stress fracture, lumbar spine. What was the reason for it? This technique. So when the back foot landing, the bowling arm should, when you are making a ball release in the back foot landing, this is that line who should pass through. The line should pass through the same leg. If the line passes through the different leg, the opposite leg, that will cause more of stress fracture and the shoulder injuries. The shoulder injuries are going to be high when during the back foot landing, the line of gravity comes to your opposite leg. If it comes to the same leg, then the chances or the injuries will be less. So because of the red line, the Hardik Pandya had the injury. If you can go through his reports in the Times of India, you can find what kind of technical fault he had. Okay, so that was the injury report, why he had. So next, there is something called, what are the injury risk predictors? So these are the predictors for lumbar stress fracture and shoulder injuries. Okay, so if during the back foot to front foot landing or front foot contact, bent knee, foot outward, trunk rotation or the side bending of the trunk, so all these technical faults is going to cause lumbar stress fracture or your shoulder injury. Okay, next, there is something called up spin bowling. Next, like something I will tell you, like unorthodox bowlers. What do you mean by unorthodox bowler? Atypical. It's not typical, atypical, like Bumrah. He is not having proper technique. He develops his force or performance with a different technique. That's why he had a stress fracture. So it is very much important. I would like to add one more point for the coaches. When an athlete is having unorthodox technique, make sure that you are having an eye on his load management compared to a same level athlete with a typical technique or orthodox technique. Orthodox technique bowler or non-orthodox technique bowler, you need to have an eye on what is the load management. Otherwise, you will come with your injury. Next, coming out of spin bowling. So how the spin bowling happens? Okay, so this is what the different spin bowling, how do they do? Okay, so if you look at what is the common thing here, so this is the common thing. So could you recognize this four bowlers? Who is he? First one, first left, Shakeel Mushtaq. Second one, Rabi Ashwin, the local guy. Next, third, Leon. Next, Harbhajan Singh. So what is the common in them? They all had more than 400 wickets, right? They all are having more than 400 plus wickets. That is the common thing. Is it true? See, the trueness is they had trunk rotation. That is the common factor. Not only they had 400 wickets, they had a trunk rotation. So the spin bowlers, they generate pace by trunk rotation compared to your fast bowler. So that is the difference of fast bowling versus off spin bowling. Okay. Next, there's some technical of Roger Federer and Rafael Nadal. So just to see how Roger Federer goes and how Rafael Nadal goes. Just I'll just quick look at the video. So this is called proper technique, proper loading. But just look at, so this is called improper technique. So who had more injury, Rafael Nadal or Roger Federer? Rafael Nadal, because of his improper technique. He could generate more force, the additional rotation force what he used to the forearm. He could generate force, he's called as clay court champion and he's not lawn tennis champion, right? If I'm not wrong. He's a clay court champion and he's lawn tennis champion. So the technical wise, what they were different, that you need to identify in each and every step of the game. Then only we can have eye on their performances and their career longevity. Okay? Next, these are some inertia based sensors what you can make use of it for identifying the muscle force production, the joint torque production. Next, there is something called KR therapy. Like there is something called lactic acid. Anybody heard about lactic acid? Lactic acid, this is the byproduct of anaerobic metabolism. When you do some quick activity, sprinting activity, muscle gets fatigued. Why? Because of the lactic acid production. So after the lactic acid production, what happens? Like if suddenly if I ask you to run for a distance, so what you will have? You will run, but after the after you run stops, you will start taking breathing from your mouth rather than taking from the nose. Why? Because the oxygen what you have used, that has to be replenished. And that is how the recovery has to happen. So why you get fatigue? Because of the deposition of the lactic acid formation. Okay. So the lactic acid formation, how you can minimize it by the using of KR therapy technology. So KR therapy, this is the time of kind of treatment technologies which helps to minimize the lactic acid accumulation and thereby it enhances the recovery. Okay. Next, recently he had visited. Who is this guy? KR therapy. Who is this guy? Josh Butler. So he had visited to one of the ABTB center, so for his recovery. Okay, so he had taken the scare therapy. Next, the intramuscular coordination, what is happening, that is feed forward and feedback mechanism. So any physio can tell me what is the difference between feed forward and feedback mechanism? Any MPT student can just find out, can just tell me what is the difference between feed forward and feedback mechanism? Have you heard of motor control? Sara Motron concept or Sally Sherman concept. What is the difference of feed forward and feedback mechanism? Just find out what it is. Feed forward mechanism means proactive. Feedback means reactive. The difference. Okay. The postural reactions what you have. Like when you move, you turn your body according to your trunk rotation. Your head moves along. This is called feed forward mechanism. Okay. And the ankle strategy and the hip strategy what you have, that is called reactive. Reactions, that the postural reactions what you studied. Okay, this is how the muscles, like the core muscles should get activated. And one more new concept on core I would like to add. So core, what is the core? Where is your core? Here? Here? Entire. So core, it is a muscular box. Everybody know about it. But which one is the major factor of core? Have you seen a Coca-Cola can? Everybody has noticed Coca-Cola can? The Coca-Cola cone will have much more tension when the can is not opened. If the can is opened, tension is not going to be more. So the Coca-Cola can, what it has, a roof, a floor, an anterior wall and a posterior wall. So if you can imagine, the Coca-Cola can bottle is a core strength. Core strength is high when the roof is not opened. When the roof is opened, tension is going to be less. So in the core concept, which one is the roof? Diaphragm. So when you are not targeting, not addressing the diaphragm, how can you expect a better core? You are just double leg rowing, crunches, sideways crunches. What about diaphragm? Are you activating diaphragm? No. Then how can you expect a good core? That is the importance of diaphragm in core. But again, the concept has changed. Core is not limited to only abdominal. Core is the central, the axial line muscles. Whatever muscle that comes in the axial line, including your deep neck stabilizers, your diaphragm, pelvic core, your hams, your quads, your calves, they all come in a core muscle. So core is not only limited to your abdominals. It is the entire axial muscle. So you need to activate. When you think of core training, entire axial muscles have to be activated. And core muscles has to be activated, feed forward mechanism. When our upper limb activity happens, core muscle, the upper limb activity should happen after the activation of core. A lower limb activation, lower limb movement should happen after the activation of core. So the core muscle should get activated in the feed forward mechanism. If they are not properly trained, then definitely it is going to cause injury. Okay. Then the few exercises what I would like to demonstrate. Sir, can I demonstrate a few techniques now? Time will be. Yeah, this. Yeah, just 1 minute I'll demonstrate. I'll just tell them. So this is like, have you seen a baby position? How the baby develops? first he will be in the supine lying position. Supine lying position with this position, could you imagine baby in this position? The baby will be in this position. Why the baby out of this position? Because of the stability. He creates stability. So when we get older, we develop faulty movement pattern. We forget the correct movement pattern. That is why in the adulthood, we need to train all the baby pattern movements. So, your supine lying, prone lying, then transition will be squat, followed by your quadruped. So these are the few stabilization exercises. The core can be activated in these all positions first, according to the new stabilization concept of your core. Next, you can go for the functional phase rehabilitation. Okay, so I'll be not talking much. Next, so can you just identify these two exercises? What are the, what are these exercises? Name? This is reverse clamp. Clamshell. These are clamshell. This is clamshell, this is reverse clamshell. Okay, so this is all about my presentation. Next, what are the takeaway messages? So machines can minimize the human error because humans are not perfect. If they would have perfect, they would have God. Okay, so it can reduce the human error and assistive. So when you require some assistance, when you're treating a multiple patients, you might not give your best for all 15 patients. So for assistive purpose, you can make use of technologies, and the technologies will make you proactive, not reactive. And feedback processes. So at every step, you will get some feedback. How much things you have done correctly? What was the error percentage in each process? And the last thing is, it can make you better, stronger athlete. The athlete can be very much better and stronger if he uses technologies in the terms of, to get his rehabilitation done. Okay. So this is all. Thank you. You can find my details here.
Yes. Thank you, Deepak. Any questions?
Yes, any questions?
So
yes, madam, please. Core muscle training is started since the baby is born. But when we get age, when our age becomes, we adapt to faulty movement patterns. We forget to go for a stabilization. Proper movement pattern, we forget. We go for a faulty movement pattern. We have been taught to sit straight. Are you sitting straight? When a phone call comes, we are making a bend. So this, we are developing a faulty movement patterns. So in the virtue of developing faulty movement pattern, are we taking care of the stabilization? As the biomechanics sir, the Ram sir has mentioned about the stability. So stability has to start from the core. Whether it is shoulder injury, whether it is foot injury, whether it is a neck injury, back injury, stability has to start from the core itself. Then only you can go to the injury side. Okay. And second thing, one more thing, when like acute, so how to, so a person with shoulder pain, where is your pain? Some patients say this, and some poor patients say like this. So what is the difference? My shoulder pain is this, my shoulder pain is this. What is the difference? Localized versus non-localized pain. And what I do with my practice with shoulder pain, like there is a quote, never mess with an angry wife. Even I am not so much experienced with my wife, but I could tell that my teacher has told me. Never mess with angry wife. Similarly, never mess with a acute shoulder pain. Just to see how conservatively you can manage. And during that phase, another example I would like to give. Suppose how many balls are there? Suppose 50 balls are there here. One of ball is not acting. So what will you do? Will you change the ball? Every time will you change the ball? You need to find whether the connection is proper or not, the switch is proper or not, or the main switch is proper or not. So always don't go to the pain site. Find out the other factors which is contributing to it. So whenever ball is, if you keep on changing the ball, your money will get finished. The company will not give what which is happening to the ball. That might be issue with the switch, that might be happening with the connecting wire, that might be issues with your main switch. Are you able to identify those all factors? No. So whenever treating a conditions, make sure that you are assessing the local as well as the global factors. So that is how you need to approach the injury.
No, I have seen kids who are into medicine ball trainings by their coaches, and they have developed abdominal hernia.
abdominal hernia.
Yeah.
So you need to measure, it's a load management.
Yeah, that's right.
Load management has to be
so
proper.
So is there any particular age so that the, for other exercises also, not only
no,
for
stability,
core,
stability is the first base. It's the foundation.
Okay. So for other exercises, like if you are involving them in some dumbbell exercises or so,
yes,
before the ossification gets completed, is it good for the kid to
yes,
go
yes,
with that?
When you are talking a pediatric athlete, to make sure that whatever high impactful exercises should not be done because that might affect the metaphyse's growth.
Okay.
High impact activities should be avoided in case of a pediatric athlete.
That's what.
That is.
What may be the age that they can start training with the weights?
Like if you talk about the metaphysis growth, the tibia is different, the ulna is different.
Okay.
So you should think what kind of training are you going to do? Are you going to do upper limb training or are you going to give lower limb training? So based on the normal physiology, at what age the ossification stops or it becomes complete, based on that you can start your exercises.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Can I just add to the question?
Yes.
The kids can do exercise, no problem with that. It's only the management of how much they play. You know, sometimes parents push the kid to the camp, they want them to do for 3 hours. So that's the problem. Otherwise, kids can do. I do kids, ask them to come to our department with weights. People say they want to do. No, a kid is 30 kg, and if he can do a push-ups, he can lift 5, 10 kgs. So you decide how much load you give. So it's not that they should not be doing gymming. You give them, if they are up to 10, 12 years, give them motor skill-based. Jumping, rolling, those are skills what we need to have for sporting. So only thing is how much you give, whether you want to do jumping weekly twice or every day. You don't need agility too much. If the kid is not ready to climb up the wall, make him climb. That's a skill. So that is how you can go and read on Canadian model of child development program. So they will give you how you need to develop a child into an athlete. So you can pick the physical components and based on that.
Another question, kids who have a physiological flat foot, can they go into sports like tennis or?
Yes, they can.
With the use of medial arts support?
See, usually until 8 years is what you need to wait to see whether they develop. You will find a lot of athletes and it's proven saying that if you are a flat feet and sporting is not correlated.
It
only if
they are
going to have a navicular drop and they are going to have pronation where they are going to tibialis posterior insufficiency, then they will have pain, then you manage the pain.
So they can play with the medial arch support, no harm in that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yes.
During the rehab exercise, you said we must strengthen the core, right?
Yes.
So what is the order of exercise? Which means we must strengthen the core first, then go on to the injured part.
Yes.
Or we should do it simultaneously, core and the injured part. What is it like?
It depends, like what is the severity of the injury of the local site, injury site. If the injury site, as I told, acute injury, do not mess with that. Because how much like when a wound is there, how much you are going to scratch, the injury is going to more. So make sure what are the global factors which is contributing to it. So when he is having it, what find are the global factors rather than finding the local factors. By the time you concentrate on the global factors, the local factors inflammation will come down. Then you can add to your local factor. And simultaneously you can start with the core training as well. Because core is the main, and core should get activated in a feed forward mechanism. Before your upper limb starts moving, your core should get activated. That is how you need to train your core. Core
so
training has to be done based on in a feed forward training.
So we should prioritize core.
Yeah, core is must. Core is must. But how we are approaching to the core, that has to be different. We are not going to approach only the front abdominal muscles. Many of will have some thought that core is means only anterior abdominal muscles, leg rowing, crunches, and X crunches. That's it. But that is not only core. As I told, core is a muscular box, and it is not only limited to your abdominal cavity. It is the hip, it is the cervical spine, it is the thigh, it is your calf. So everything is whichever comes in the axial line, they all are core. So you need to activate the core in the line, not in the specific body segment.
When have they added like even the hip and quadriceps and hamstring and glutes to the core? Actually, I have studied like core is made of diaphragm, abdomen muscles, transverse muscles, and the back muscles and the pelvic floor muscles. But when they have added it, like
When I have added it.
No, when they have added, I didn't study about that. It's a new information.
No, it is not about added. When I have asked to do a perform a squatting activity, do you think only your core is getting activated? With your core, all your axial muscles are getting activated. They has to get activated isometrically. They has to get activated isometrically. That is something called local muscle versus global muscle, mobilizer versus stabilizer muscles. If you go more of the functional classification of the muscle, you will get this idea of how the core concept has been developed.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Okay. There is something called DNS approach, dynamic neuromuscular stabilization approach. If you can go through that, you will get more about core training. Okay. Thank you.
Just to add on to the core, your questions were the muscles, you know. So there is an inner core where we talk only diaphragm, then your transverse abdominis, multifidus, and the pelvic floor. That's the common. Then you go global, then anything that is connecting to the scapula, shoulder, hip, all will be here. So that's why in any textbooks, when you say rotator cuff, you'll get only four muscles. But you'll have never any book mentioning core muscles, these are the muscles. Because none of the authors are very sure. And when you say core is, you know, here, it's shoulder, everything, then it goes into kinetic chain. Core is a concept that was evolved in the 70s, where they said that, and they caught hold of the rest. And now, in research, we are proving that core is not very important. We are proving. And in another 3 years, if you're studying now core, in 3 years, you will know that core is not important. Okay? So, understand the concepts, believe on the concepts, apply it, and see the outcome. Don't blindly follow. See the outcome, whether it is working or not. And no one thing will follow and give results for everybody. So you need to find your inputs, the response on your patients or clients, and based on that, you modify them.
And that in the technical point of view, what you have told, sir, has told, none of the techniques, like there are many techniques in the physiotherapy, starting from the first two studied in Maitland, Carlton one. Now, osteopathic, chiropractic, Mulligan, this, that, many things has come. But none of the techniques are superior than other. None of the techniques are superior than other. Everybody has different indications. If I talk about bike, there are three bikes I will take you. R15 bike, Royal Enfield bike, and a Scooty bike. Can you tell me which one is better? The best bike. R15, Bullet 350 or 650 or your Scooty. Which one is the best bike? Can you tell me which one is the best bike? Which one? Sorry? R15 is more cruiser bike, right? But you want more of speed, you will be using R15. Long ride, you will be using Bullet. But in the traffic, which one you will be using? Scooty. So it is like how you are making use of it. You cannot say Scooty is bad, R15 is good. So similarly, you cannot say that any technique is wrong, any technique is superior. All the technique has its own indications and contraindications. It is like how we are making use of it. People are saying now this electrotherapy is outdated. We are outdated. Electrotherapy is not outdated. Maitland is outdated. Maitland is not outdated. We are outdated. So don't say that any technique is outdated. Just you should know when to make use of that particular technique. That's it. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thanks a lot, sir. Excellent demonstration on day two, and we enjoyed the session pretty much. And we are coming to the conclusion of this program. Thanks a lot for your great efforts. I thank the faculties, the delegates, the organizing team, the video link team from Anand, and our sponsors. We will conclude the session with the national anthem. Thank you all. Have a good evening.